Thank you, Mr. Tambini, and good afternoon, commissioners. We have a public hearing today on the commission's fiscal year 2016 operating budget and capital budget. Before I begin, I just wanted to extend my appreciation to the commissioners and their staff over the past several months working with myself and my staff in the development of this budget. So once again, thank you very much for your kind consideration and assistance. The commission has prepared and posted, made available a document entitled the Delaware River Basin Commission's Current Expense and Capital Budget for the period July 1, 2015 through June 30, 2016. It contains the general fund operating budget, the water supply storage and facilities fund budget, as well as the annual work plan for fiscal year 16. Associated with the adoption of that document, I'll be presenting two resolutions. The first of which would be the apportionment among the signatory parties to support the commission's operating budget. The first resolution provides for a contribution from the state of Delaware in the amount of $447,000, New Jersey $693,000, New York $359,500, Pennsylvania $750,000, and the federal government $715,000, with a total signatory contributions totaling $2,964,500. By way of background, the funds noted above are in the respective budgets of the governors for Delaware, New Jersey, and Pennsylvania. The number of $359,500 is in the adopted budget for the state of New York. The federal government $715,000 represents the commission's fair share allocation to the federal government. That budget, this budget resolution will be presented tomorrow in concert with the following budget resolution, which let me go through in greater detail. The second resolution provides for the adoption of the budget for fiscal year 16. The aggregate amount of the general fund operating budget is $5,675,100. Our capital budget, the Water Supply Storage Facilities Fund, has revenues reflecting $4,053,300 and expenditures in the amount of $3,642,900. In addition, this budget provides for the $2,964,500, as I noted previously in the prior resolution that you'll be presented tomorrow, representing the signatory apportionments. We're also providing for a transfer from the Water Supply Storage Facilities Fund in the amount of $1,870,200. And we have various transfers in and out of special projects of $299,500 and other revenues totaling $540,900 for a total of $2,710,600. This resolution recognizes that the adoption of the budget is tied to the budgetary processes of the various signatory states and the federal government. It also provides for the executive director to transmit a certified statement to each of the budget offices as relates to the apportioned amount. It also provides for the executive director to reevaluate the annual work plan and make modifications should revenues fall below that which is in the approved budget. The budget also provides for the Delaware River Basin Commission to continue operating the Pennsylvania Groundwater Protected Area Program in 2016. The estimated cost of the program in fiscal 16 is $123,000. The commission anticipates receiving $63,000 from the Commonwealth in fiscal year 16 to fully fund this activity. The FY16 budget provides a level staffing, same as FY15. We have approximately 39 full-time equivalent employees. There are no changes to our fee structures, both to the project review structure in FY16. The anticipated revenues, both for project review and our compliance revenues, are consistent with that which we adopted in FY15, approximately $500,000 in total. There are no changes to the fee structure associated with our water charging program. The budget provides for some building improvements associated with our heating and ventilating system. But other than that, I have to say that it's a reasonably status quo budget, and look forward to any questions and comments that the commissioners may have associated with these documents.
Thank you, Mr. Moore. Any questions or comments from the committee? Seeing none, we'll open it to public comments. I don't have anyone registered to speak on these two resolutions, but I'll open the floor to see if anyone would like to speak. Okay.
I have a question, if I may. I probably wasn't paying proper attention.
You identify yourself? Please?
Pardon? Oh, identify.
No,
myself.
We
do have a court reporter. This is public hearing. Please.
My name is Mary Ellen Noble with the Delaware Riverkeeper Network. I'm confused. It sounds like we're getting more money from more states than we did before, but I'm not clear about it. Is there any one state that is putting up their full fair share?
That would be the state of Delaware.
All right, and Pennsylvania is putting up more than it has in the past, but not a full share.
Pennsylvania's contribution is $750,000 to the general fund and another $63,000 to our PA groundwater program.
But that's not quite the full share.
I believe the full share allocation would be $889,000.
And
it's a significant increase over last year's amount.
That is. And then New York is about the same way.
Same level as in FY15. And New York's contribution is $359,500. And that is contained in the governor's budget for FY16.
That's very nice. And so we're left with New Jersey, if you wouldn't mind saying.
New Jersey's contribution is $693,000. And that amount is also contained in the governor's proposed FY16 budget, clearly subject to their budgetary processes.
That's not the full amount.
Same as prior year.
Thank you very much. And that leaves the federal government, who, as usual, leaves us whistling in the wind. Is that correct?
Well, you characterize it that way. We characterize it to be our what we represent, the federal government's fair share. And we have provided that in the amount of $715,000 for the consideration of the commissioners.
Oh, how soon does the report, I guess it's OMB has, or somebody has to write a report now saying why it didn't go in.
Well, I think you may be confusing that with some language in Worden, and I don't believe that is tied to the budgetary process.
Not to yours, but I mean, okay. If they don't put up money, Worden said they had to do something.
I believe there's some language associated with the requirement of the Secretary of the Army to provide a report to Congress absent funding the
right.
River
the
Basin.
The Secretary of the Army is going to tell Congress why they didn't put up the money.
That's my understanding of the provision of the word of the law.
I look forward to it.
Right. Thank you.
Any other comments? Thank you, Mr.
All right, thank you.
We're going to move on to propose one process on current rule.
Can you get that up on the board?
Good afternoon, commissioners. As soon as we get the PowerPoint up, we can begin. The commissioners will recall that on March 11, 2015, can we go to the second slide? Oh, the feedback's coming from. The commissioners will recall that in March 11, 2015, they approved resolution number 2015-4, and that resolution authorized the executive director to initiate rulemaking to provide specific authorization for and define the scope of the One Process, One Permit program. In addition, that resolution provided the authorization to enter into an administrative agreement with New Jersey to provide for a demonstration program that would demonstrate the One Process, One Permit program for wastewater treatment discharge facilities. The agreement with New Jersey was executed on April 14th, 2015. Next slide. The authorizations for DRBC to enter into these disagreement come from the compact, section 1.5, which not only authorizes but directs the commission to utilize and employ existing offices and agencies of governments to the fullest extent feasible and advantageous for the purposes of the compact. In addition, compact section 3.9 provides that DRBC shall promote and aid the coordination of activities and programs of federal, state, municipal, and private agencies concerned with water administration, water resource administrations in the basin. The RPP section,
Rules of Practice.
Rules and Practice and Procedure, thank you. Blank on an acronym after all these years. Anyway, section 2.33 authorizes DRBC, current section RPP, authorizes DRBC to enter into administrative agreements with federal agencies, federal and state agencies, to meet the objectives of its regulatory programs. And commissioners will recall that at some point, back in the 1970s, the commission did enter into agreements with state signatory parties, and as recently as 2009 and 2010, entered into revised agreements with both New Jersey and Delaware. The purpose of the One Process, One Permit program, and why we're proposing it is really to provide for eligible projects to be managed through a single process resulting in one decision or approval. It's to make the process simpler for regulated entities to understand and to follow and to comply with, provide for procedural efficiency, promote collaboration, improve compliance. We've noted that in the NOVs that occasionally come before the commission that there is confusion as to, say, the NPDES permit program and a docket. So this should improve compliance, which is what we really do want, and also to achieve the same or improved environmental results. I want to emphasize that the Neither the rule nor the agreements that we're entering into do not change the substantive authority or regulatory standards of the commission or of any of the state agencies that enter into those agreements with us. The regulatory programs that will be included, the proposed rule provides that all of the projects that are reviewable under the compact and DRBC rules can be included. However, they must also be identified separately in a duly adopted administrative agreement. And by duly adopted administrative agreement, we're talking of an agreement that has been subject to the public process, including a public hearing. Initially, the agreement that we have with New Jersey provides for water and wastewater discharge programs, and we anticipate that being similar for the other states. Other programs, though, can be added by amending those administrative agreements. Again, amendment of those agreements take the same form. They must be subject to the public process, including a hearing. Describe a little bit about the key provisions of the rule. The rule provides that where the signatory party agency is the lead on these projects, there'll be a single application filed with that party. Notice of that application filing is provided to DRBC. DRBC gets to review and provide recommendations relative to Section 3.8 of the compact, and Section 3.8 of the compact is really the foundation our authority for DRBC to review projects and to approve them, and are required to be approved in the basin that have anything to do with substantive water resource impacts. The signatory party then may make a project review determination under this Section 3.8 and following our review and recommendations to them. And then DRBC will maintain a list of all projects administered pursuant to the one process, one permit program. We note that we will be making that list public. It will be on our website, as we currently do with the current AA programs that we have in place. For projects that need to be entered into our comprehensive plan, they can only be entered into the comprehensive plan by a separate action of the commission after public hearing. That would require a separate application to the commission, and that's required prior to the project design. Commission approval then would include the requirements under the compact commission regulations. It is anticipated for those projects that would then fall under the one permit, one process, one permit program that the state, say it's an NPDES program, permit would include then incorporate those requirements into it as well, and as well as the finding, and then you eventually would get into the one process review for that. But the adding of projects to the comprehensive plan must be done by commission action. Our commission review and enforcement authorities are retained as part of the rule. And one of the key parts of the rules also is that any commissioner or the executive director may designate any reviewable project for separate commission and review. Essentially that translates to it taking it out of the one permit, one process permit and having the commission issue a separate action in that particular instance. The rule provides that an appellant must first exhaust its administrative remedies under the law of the signatory party under which that particular permit would be processed before an appeal to the commission. Fees, there's the provision in the rule that unless and until modified by the commission, the current fee schedule remains in place and applicable to projects reviewed under the one process, one permit program, and project sponsors must pay those fees directly to the commission. There is still a commission review being performed. While we're simplifying some of the administrative procedures, However, since the review needs to be performed, the fee is still applicable. The rule also provides that the executive director can terminate some of the docket either in part or whole. There are cases where we would choose to do that because there's one permit is in place, say the NPDS permit is in place. But that termination does not serve to remove that project or modify that project under the CP. In accordance with Section 3.3A of the compact, no authority granted to any signatory party is being granted under this particular rule to affect the terms of the Supreme Court decree of 1954. And that, of course, has to do with the New Jersey versus New York and the water reservoir systems. Just to review the schedule once more, on May 7th of this year, 2015, the draft rule was published on our websites. It was also submitted to the Federal Register and appeared at various dates in the federal and state registers. Today we're holding the public hearing on this particular rule. July 1st of 2015, the comment period closes, so all written or comments must be in to the commission by the close of business of that date. Between July and September, commission staff anticipates preparing a response to the comments that we receive and then potentially provide to the commissioners on September 16th, which is the next scheduled commission meeting, a comment response document as well as recommendations for any changes to the rule, and anticipating a vote on that date. Sometime in mid-September after that date, the commission, the DRBC could then expect to adopt a final rule. I want to once again emphasize that written comments, we're getting oral comments as well today here at the hearing, but written comments can be provided to us at this hearing, or you can send emails to Paula Schmidt at drbc.state.nj.us. Comments can be faxed to the commission, and our fax number is up there. It's 609-883-9522. Or send through the U.S. mail to the commission secretary at DRBC, Post Office Box 7360, West Trenton, New Jersey. again, emphasizing that the comment period closes on July 1st. There are copies of the documents on our website. The New Jersey DRBC administrative agreement that was approved to move on March 14th, but has actually put into effect on April 14th by the signatures. There's frequently asked questions that are up there, and you can also contact either Pam Busher or myself with questions, but I emphasize that when questions come in, you still must submit your written comments in accordance with the procedure I just mentioned earlier.
As Bill mentioned, this was an ultimately brief presentation, and it's certainly an important topic. So if you need more information, please visit the website. There are several people who ask questions there, and I think they provide additional information. As Bill stated, the comment period will be open until July 1st. Do you see if there's any comments or questions from the commission?
Just one point of clarification. If the commission were to adopt this on September 16th at its meeting, that would be the final decision of the commission on that issue. It would not require a separate subsequent action by the commission.
Okay. Thank you. We're going to open up to the public. We're going to start with those who had signed up for the next in advance. We have 13 people who signed up in advance. Please, as I stated earlier, we're going to start with a 3-minute time limit. So please keep your comments to 3 minutes. The time limit at some point will be up on the wall there. I'm going to read the names, and I'll read the next name as well, so the person can be ready. So the first name is going to be Jeff Zimmerman. The next name is Al Patterson.
Pardon. I'm sorry. Balance today. I'm Jeff Zimmerman. We're going to present our witness.
Can you please speak to the microphone, please?
Yes.
We actually have some changes in who's presenting our testimony today. I'd like to begin with Barbara Arendelle, followed by Shirley Masao, Mav Moorhead, Buck Moorhead, and then I'll conclude. So how would you like us to proceed?
All the people have signed up, so if you want to switch the order more efficiently, we appreciate it.
Thank you. We'll try to be efficient.
Hello, my name is Barbara Arendelle. I'm speaking today on behalf of Damascus Citizens for Sustainability, NYH2O, and Citizens for Water. The Delaware River Basin Compact was adopted by the four states of Delaware, New Jersey, New York, and Pennsylvania, and the federal government to protect the water quality and water quantity of the water supply for over 16 million people. The intent was to make sure that projects might have a substantial effect on the water supply would be reviewed by all five parties to the compact with public input, regardless of where in the river basin a project might be located. The process provides an additional layer of review over and above any state-specific review that might apply to a particular project. The rationale for the Commission's review is simple and direct. All of the water resources of the basin are incorporated in a comprehensive plan adopted by the Commission. Each project must be reviewed by the five Commission parties to determine whether it may have a substantial effect on the water resources addressed in the comprehensive plan. If a project would have an adverse impact, then it must be rejected. The intent of the compact was to make review of projects a rigorous and thorough process. The water resources of the Delaware River Basin are so critical to so many people that every possible layer of review must be used to preserve the integrity of this water supply. The one process, one permit proposal now before you would eviscerate the project review process required by the compact. If this proposal is adopted, the responsibility of the members of the commission will be compromised and abdicated in violation of the compact. It is your obligation as commissioners to reject this proposal. Thank you for your attention, and we will be happy to answer any questions you may have, and we will be submitting more extensive written comments before the end of the comment period.
My name is Shirley Masuo, and I am speaking today on behalf of Damascus Citizens for Sustainability, NYH2O, and Citizens for Water. Building on Ms. Arendelle's testimony, I would like to address the public participation aspect of the One Process, One Permit proposal. The frequently asked question file for the proposal indicates that the public will have opportunities to comment on proposed administrative agreements between DRBC and a compact state or federal agency. However, once an administrative agreement is approved by the Commission, public input on any particular project that seeks state approval is limited to the public input procedures for the applicable state regulatory program. This may result in far less opportunity for public comment than currently provided by DRBC procedures. Under DRBC rules, the public may start submitting comments on a proposed project as soon as an application is filed or a docket for a proposal is established. The public may continue to supplement comments as a proposal is prepared for commission action. Also, there is an opportunity to present testimony on each docketed proposal before the commission acts. Further, Article 6 of the Commission's Rules and Practice and Procedure provides, on approval by the Commission, an opportunity in a contested case for an administrative hearing before a hearing officer. This hearing allows the submission of evidence through witnesses, including expert witnesses, and reports. The hearing procedure also allows cross-examination of witnesses for the other parties. It is our experience that state permit proceedings do not provide nearly as much opportunity as DRBC for public input. Usually there is only one opportunity for public comment at the end of a permit process. There is nothing similar to the DRBC's Article 6 process in most state programs. And we will provide a summary of public input opportunities under various state programs in our written comments. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Mav Moorhead, and I'm speaking today on behalf of Damascus Citizens for Sustainability, NYH2O, and Citizens for Water. The subject I will address is environmental review of projects under the One Process, One Permit proposal. Over the years since its creation, DRBC has always conducted environmental impact reviews of pending projects and taken the results of such reviews into consideration in permitting decisions. Under the One Process, One Permit proposal, this would change. Under the proposal, the nature and depth of environmental review would vary depending upon the state where a project is located. If a project is located in New York, a very rigorous environmental review would apply to each project, subject to the environmental impact statement requirements of the State Environmental Quality Review Act, also known as CEQRA. While not being as broad in scope as or as detailed in required actions as New York CEQRA, New Jersey has an environmental review requirement under the Governor's Executive Order 215 for projects initiated or funded in part by a state agency. In contrast, neither Delaware nor Pennsylvania has any regulatory provision requiring an environmental review in connection with any permitting action. In fact, the Pennsylvania Department of Environmental Protection admitted in litigation filed by us that oil and gas drilling permits are granted with less than 35 minutes of review per permit, including any environmental review. Any proposal that does not assure an environmental review for each project, at least as thorough as the DRBC review, must be rejected. One process, one permit fails to meet this standard. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Apologies for the sound. Is that supplemental mic causing interference?
Yes, sir. Who's this at?
You want to try and move it and see if it is?
Just move it to the other side. How's that?
So I guess I'm the guinea pig on this change here, speaker change. My name is Buck Moorhead. I'm speaking here today on behalf of Damascus Citizens for Sustainability, NYH2O, and Citizens for Water as well. The topic I would like to address is enforcement. As stated by the speakers preceding me, we are opposed to the adoption of One Process, One Permit proposal. However, if such a program is adopted, the key to success is not merely preparing the right permit, but enforcing the requirements of that permit once it is issued. We understand that the primary enforcement responsibility on any permit will be the issuing agency, whether that is the DRBC or a state that has entered into an administrative agreement with the commission. Both the commission and the state agencies continue to operate on limited budgets. This will include the resources available to enforce the permit conditions. In order to maximize the effectiveness of the enforcement program, we urge the commission to add its own enforcement personnel resources to enforcing state permits issued under a program of the type proposed today. I just want to repeat that. In order to maximize the effectiveness of the enforcement program, we urge the commission to add its own enforcement personnel resources to enforcing state permits issued under a program of the type proposed today. Additionally, we strongly suggest that any agreements between the commission and the state or federal agency recognize and facilitate citizen input to the enforcement program. Taking advantage of citizen eyes and ears can effectively supplement commission agency enforcement personnel. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman and members of the commission, my name is Jeff Zimmerman. I just have one or two thoughts to supplement the testimony for DCS, NYH2O, and Citizens for Water. We're going to be taking a look at, and including in our comments, a comparison of the standards of review for actions undertaken under the one process, one permit rule. As you know, the compact provides for judicial review of final agency actions by the commission. State laws generally have somewhat similar, but it may not be exactly the same, requirements for judicial review and a standard of review that applies to any decisions that they are under review. I ask you to make sure you take a careful look at the standards of review under the commission rules and commission for the compact procedures and under the state statutes that would be involved in any proposal that you adopt. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you for your comments. We're going to go with Kenneth Collins and then Kathy Klein.
Good afternoon. I'm Kenneth Collins from Andover, New Jersey. The NJDEP has shown that it is a politically affected organization that takes action according to its political agenda, allowing the NJDEP to oversee anything that would ordinarily be overseen by the DRBC sends us down a very slippery slope. One process, one permit reduces the time and opportunity for the public to consider and voice their concerns. These opportunities are currently very limited, and reducing these opportunities is unacceptable and conflicts with the DRBC's mission statement, which states that the DRBC will seek increased public involvement. The one process, one permit program further alienates and disenfranchises the public, as many besides myself will communicate to you. And it would be a capricious action for you to take. I ask you vehemently not to implement the one process, one permit program. Thank you.
Thank you. Kathy Klein and Dennis Palmer, please.
Good afternoon. My name is Kathy Klein, and I am president of the Water Resources Association of the Delaware River Basin. WRA is a 501c3 nonprofit organization established in 1959. WRA has members from industry, public and private utilities, other diverse organizations, and individuals that have wide-ranging interests in water resources and a commitment to ensuring public participation in the management of the water resources of the Delaware River Basin. WRA supports the One Process, One Permit program and its goals of improving collaboration among DRBC and state environmental agencies in the four basin states, promoting regulatory program efficiencies, and reducing duplication in the permitting and approval process for water resource-related projects, initially in the areas of water withdrawals and state water allocations and diversion programs, and wastewater discharges in state MPDES or water quality programs. By providing for implementation of the most protective of DRBC and state requirements, the One Process, One Permit program will achieve equal or better environmental outcomes with greater administrative efficiency than current practices allow. While we support the proposed rule changes that provide authorization for and defines the scope of the One Process, One Permit program, we are concerned about the lack of administrative details as to how DRBC will continue to collect permit application fees under this initiative. These details need to be clearly addressed before any implementation of this program can move forward. WRA believes there is a need for infrastructure improvements to maintain and improve water quality and to manage and ensure flows to support in-stream needs and water withdrawals for a variety of purposes, including potable uses in the Delaware River Basin. The One Process, One Permit program will help to achieve a timely and efficient process for meeting these water management goals. Thank you.
Thank you. Dennis Palmer and Bill Wolf.
Executive Director, Commissioners, good afternoon. My name is Dennis Palmer. I'm here representing the New Jersey Water Environment Association. Association of almost 3,000 members, operators, consultants, engineers, academia who are involved in water resources issues. We've also been the ones who actually provide the clean water. We celebrate our 100 years this year. I have written comments. I've already emailed them in. I'll leave a copy with Bill here. Basically, we support 100% this process. We have a multi-billion dollar need in New Jersey for infrastructure. The efficiencies we're hoping this provides with the one-stop and the ability to move forward those infrastructure projects for clean water will be invaluable to the citizens. In deference to everyone in the room, I'll leave my written comments. Thank you.
Thank you. Bill Wolf and then Maya Ross.
Good afternoon, Bill Wolf, Bordentown. I just came to make a few remarks, speaking off the top of my head, as someone who's been involved with permitting and water quality management planning and land use planning and water resource protection on the New Jersey side for 20 years or more. I think the whole concept of one process, one permit is just fatally flawed and is inconsistent with the entire mission and purpose of the DRBC. I think folks have alluded to that previously. I don't really need to expand on that, but delegating administrative authority to a state is at odds with the notion of a regional compact with a sense of a region, planning for a region, and basing needs and goals and objectives and water resource decisions based on a regional vision. The second point I think that needs to be made is that New Jersey is not a reliable partner. That's putting it as kindly as I possibly can. There's a track record here. There's a formal regulatory policy pursuant to an executive order of Governor Christie. Executive Order Number 2 established a formal regulatory policy of, quote, regulatory relief. That's the term that's used in the Executive Order Number 2. The DEP has expanded upon that and come up with all kinds of flexibility and pro-economic development policies that relax protections on water resources. And at this point in time, they've fallen down on the job in updating the statewide water supply plan. They've used the water quality management plan to promote economic development and relax environmental protections on how lands were in sewer service areas. The NJPDES permit process is not user-friendly. I go to a public hearing, and there's typically, I'm the only one there. They don't really facilitate public involvement. And there are real problems with allowing a state to go forward with administrative permitting authority in the absence of good regional planning. And if you really want to do this right, the planning has to precede the delegation of administrative permitting. Permit needs to be issued in accordance with a plan that makes sense for the region as a whole. Then you would have some accountability and standards upon which to feel confident that a state is making permit decisions in accordance with a plan. And currently you don't have that. You don't have those standards that I'm aware of that are sufficient. And like I said, the state is not allowed to report. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is
Austin, friend of Canada.
Hi, I'm Maya Vamros, and I'm the Delaware Riverkeeper. I'm here speaking on behalf of the Delaware Riverkeeper Network. I do have written comments. They're en route from my office right now because they got left behind. But I do have some verbal comments as well. The Delaware Riverkeeper Network is opposed to the One Process, One Permit program. We believe the program will undermine DRBC authority. It will undermine the ability of the commissioners to weigh in on water quality impacts and threats. It will undermine the watershed-based approach to decision-making and protection, and it will undermine public participation in project review and the decision-making process. To the extent that the program does advance for the demonstration period, important modifications are critically necessary. The Delaware Riverkeeper Network is submitting significant written comment, but I'm going to highlight a few key points in the time that I have today. Most importantly, because this is a new program with such far-reaching impacts, because it's a program that's intended to be replicated in other states, and that may include at some future point other aspects of DRBC authority, the program needs to include an explicit mechanism for the evaluation of the demonstration's implementation. This evaluation, this review, should evaluate the success of the program at having states fully and fairly apply DRBC regulations and mandates. It should evaluate the effect on the public process. It should evaluate the program's ability to keep commissioners and other states informed and engaged on decisions that impact their watershed resources and states, and it should evaluate the impacts on water quality and on waterway health. Once the evaluation has been completed, it should be provided to the commissioners, to the public, for review and for input. And this entire evaluation review process, including public review and input, needs to be completed before the program is allowed to continue beyond the demonstration period in New Jersey or elsewhere, in order to allow you to decide whether or not the program was in fact a success and you want to continue it, and in order to allow the opportunity to make necessary modifications that have been highlighted by the experience of going through the demonstration. The program needs to be modified to make DRBC the lead agency in a number of key areas, including for all new project proposals that could impact the main stem Delaware River, for all projects that it could impact special protection waters, for any proposals that involve the import of wastewater of over 50,000 gallons from outside of the Delaware River Basin. The need for DRBC to be the lead in these situations is made more pronounced and obvious given the potential for dangerous fracking wastewater, including wastewater contaminated with radioactive materials, to be imported for treatment and disposal in our watershed. And the DRBC needs to be the lead agency on any and all proposals that seek relief from reduction of or modification of DRBC requirements to ensure that the goals of the DRBC and the rights of all watershed beneficiaries are protected. Thank you.
Any further comments? Just one point of clarification. Clearly, there's many enrollments to this program. However, the administrative agreements have been in place since the 1970s. Similar administrative agreements. So similar programs have been in place for quite some time. You can go to our website and look at those administrative agreements anytime. Thank you. Brenda?
Hi.
After that, we'll be double now.
Thank you. My name is Brenda Gotanda, and I am with Mango Gold, Catcher, and Fox, and I'm here today on behalf of the Delaware Estuary TMDL Coalition. The members of the coalition include Amtrak, Camden County Municipal Utilities Authority, Calpine, Delcora, DuPont and Chemours, Exelon Generation Company, PBF Delaware City and Paulsboro Refineries, Philadelphia Water Department, PSEG Power, Roman Haas, and Philadelphia Energy Solutions. I speak today in support of the One Process, One Permit program proposed regulations. The concepts embodied in the proposed regulations really build upon decades of experience that DRBC and the states have had in working together to coordinate project reviews based on the particular legal requirements of each party. They promote the purposes of the compact. As Bill indicated in his PowerPoint, Section 1.5 of the Compact directs the Commission to utilize and employ the authorities of the basin states to the fullest extent it finds feasible and advantageous. The program is well crafted with a clear allocation of responsibilities and procedures for coordinated reviews. The proposed regulations properly reflect the evolution of the permitting programs administered by the states, including the NPDES permit program. They strike the proper balance in integrating the substantive standards of both the states and DRBC through a coordinated process that'll culminate in a single comprehensive permit with more opportunity for public comment given the longer comment periods and state permitting procedures. These regulations reflect the legal standard and that the legal standard will be the more stringent of the state or DRBC, and that should be the one to be applied, thereby reducing the chance for conflicting or inconsistent requirements and more timely decision making. The proposed regulations will eliminate duplicative reviews and enable scarce agency resources to be conserved and redeployed to other priority programs without overlap. The coalition believes this is a realistic and well-conceived approach that thoughtfully considers limited agency resources while continuing to implement DRBC's requirements in an effective and streamlined manner. The coalition supports the program established by the proposed regulations. On behalf of the coalition, we'll be submitting written comments with additional observations and recommendations regarding specific elements of the proposed regulations. Thank you.
Thank you. Doug O'Malley, and that will be the last of the pre-reg, so we'll only have at least one after that.
Thank you, Director. Thank you, Director Tandini. Good afternoon. My name is Doug O'Malley. I'm the Director of Environment New Jersey. We represent more than 20,000 citizen members across this great state. And I just wanted to start off by saying that, you know, we are happy to be joined by the Delaware Riverkeeper, Damascus Citizens, New Jersey, up here as well from New Jersey Sierra Club, expressing our massive concerns with one permit, one process. This proposal would ultimately have DRBC become a second-class citizen. And, you know, we're only a few miles from Princeton University right now. One of their established, most well-known alumni, ex-Captain Cheryl, famously said, "The sign of an intelligent mind is holding two diametrically opposed ideas in your brain at the same time." And my fear is that DRBC is being too clever by half here, because you quite simply cannot have, or at least in this proposal as outlined, you cannot have a bureaucratic efficiency as well as increased environmental protection. And the concerns that we've heard outlined, including the concerns around public participation, really are legitimate, and DRBC needs to look at the degree of public input and involvement that states encourage, because quite frankly, you know, we don't see enough of it here in New Jersey, and DRBC essentially is a neutral party. And the concern is that DRBC suddenly will not become that neutral party as much as it has been in the past. I also just want to, you know, hone in specifically on our concerns working with New Jersey DEP and the structure of New Jersey as a whole. New Jersey's governorship is one of the most powerful in the nation. And over the course of the Christie administration, we really have seen a direct involvement of politics in environmental policy making. And the environmental record, specifically on water quality under New Jersey DEP, has been abysmal. But to be more accurate, the political involvement of the Christie administration in multiple arenas, from the Pinelands Commission to most recently the Drinking Water Quality Institute, it's real. Drinking Water Quality Institute was placed essentially in deep freeze for close to 4 years. Their most recent meetings show a true sound, true ability for independence looking at PFNA. And unfortunately, DEP will ultimately be the decider on that. We don't want to be in a situation where DRBC is at a similar mercy. And then just in conclusion, just recently there was an ethics violation filed against Christy Renner in the governor's front office regarding the direct involvement in the Pinelands. The Pinelands Commission supposedly being an independent body. This shows that our concerns aren't just rhetoric. This is why it's important to have an independent body and not to be tying DRBC to the individual states, including New Jersey. Thank you.
Thank you. I have one speaker who signed up today, Jeff Tittle. Jeff, before you start, let me see it. Just a show of hands. Anyone else want to speak on one process, one permit? 1, 2, 3, 4. Four more after this.
Thank you. Jeff Tittle, Director of New Jersey Sierra Club, and we're here to oppose one flush permitting, because that's what it really is. The point of having independent reviews is to be a backstop against what may or may not happen at the state level. States do not have the responsibility, the time, or the people to look at the impact secondarily and cumulatively throughout the basin. When you look at a New Jersey DEP watershed map, it ends at the border of the watershed. It doesn't continue into Pennsylvania or Delaware. That is the problem, and that's why you were created, because the states on their own could not manage the water resources of this basin. You know, we have a compact for a reason. You know, now you want to turn that compact into a powder puff because you're giving away your authority and you're allowing the states to do what they want. That is the biggest problem, because there will not be a backstop. Not only that, you're doing it to save money, and guess what? You know, eventually the large dischargers that are here supporting will say that they shouldn't give you any money, then you're going to lose your staff. But more importantly, that little bit of savings that you may have is penny wise and pound foolish. Because for a little bit of money now, the environmental costs are going to be devastating. The costs to the 15 million people who get their drinking water will go up because of additional treatment costs. When you look at New Jersey's record on clean water, it's been abysmal over the last 5 years. We've seen rollback after rollback of program, including just recently the flood hazard rules. We've seen rollback in the C1 program. We've seen massive areas that were environmentally sensitive, being pulled out of sewer service, now going back in, including more than 20,000 acres in the Pinelands. We see a state that has passed a law that increased the size of package plants from 20,000 gallons to 50,000 gallons. There's a bill moving through the legislature right now that says sewage sludge is no longer hazardous. New Jersey has the worst record on combined sewer overflows, and we're running sewer lines into the middle of nowhere. And we do not have the proper environmental reviews. We do not have a CEQA process. Our EIS system is flawed. If it's privately paid for the infrastructure, there is no environmental review, and we have tax increment financing that gets around public financing. Right now, there's a proposal for a sewer plant in New Egypt that violates the Clean Water Act. It doesn't meet standards for suspended solids, for metals. It's discharging of impaired water body, and the state's going to approve it. That's why we need you as a backstop. That is your job. DRBC, do not ruin the Basin Commission. Do your job, keep your review process, and follow the law that you're intended to follow. Don't leave it up to the states, because it will not happen if you leave it up to the states. The 15 million people who get their drinking water depend on it. This is a sneak attack on clean water by the Christie administration and others, and the states don't have the resources or the political will to protect that water quality and that water supply for all these people. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. I would just say that I would encourage everybody to look at how projects are reviewed right now. And I would say that the scope of the DRBC review for projects under this program is not changing. Not at all. Effectively, we are collaborating and cooperating right now. We'll be doing that in a more better and efficient fashion. So it's not, the scope of our reviews are not changing. Someone else wanted to speak?
Wendy Getz, Freeland Heights in New Jersey. No matter the scopes or the changes or the process, Governor Christie wants to frack in the Delaware River Basin. You all have made the moratorium, and we all thank you for the moratorium in the basin. And this is a play of the NJDEP to get more involved in the process. Regardless of the updates and the processes, the Article 6 process and your process allows the public interface. It allows for you to contemplate each project itself. I would not send a security guard from a bank to do a fireman's job. And please, do not give Governor Christie a baton in this relay race.
Good afternoon. I'm Carrie Butch. I'm the executive director of the League of Women Voters of New Jersey. And we are here because we're very concerned that we would still like a robust public process, public hearing process on this matter. And we would just like you to increase it. We feel that it's an amazing thing that you guys are trying to do as far as its reach and the communities that are going to be impacted by the permitting process. Really, the people in those communities deserve to have their say. So we're here to really encourage you. We know that you believe and that that you are committed to an increased public participation. We ask you that you make it a top priority, and you continue to do that. Increase the amount of public hearings on this issue. Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Aaron Stempowitz. I'm a staff attorney at the Delaware Riverkeeper Network. And just referencing Myvan Rossum's comments earlier, DRN is well aware that there are state administrative agreements, and they've existed since the 70s, but DRN is also well aware that in the past these state administrative agreements have been ignored by the states. In fact, there is deposition testimony from high-ranking Pennsylvania Department of Environmental Protection officials, for example, the section chief of the Sewage Facilities Planning and Biosolids section, that they don't comply with those very state administrative agreements. So we have very serious concerns that moving forward, states will comply with those administrative agreements. And secondly, I just want to reference something that was made on the slideshow or presented on the slideshow earlier. I would encourage the Commission in their consideration of this document to take into account the Natural Gas Act and particularly the appeals mechanism that is contained within the Natural Gas Act, which dictates that any initial decision that is made is immediately appealed. The right jurisdiction is immediately appealed to the circuit court that has proper jurisdiction. There is no exhaustion of administrative remedies or anything like that. So I encourage the commission to take a look at section 717 RD1 and make sure that they're well aware that that provision exists, because the Pennsylvania Department of Environmental Protection sort of has failed to understand the repercussions of that provision, and there's currently litigation ongoing, and I would encourage the commission to follow that litigation. That concludes my comments. Thank you.
Thank you.
Attached to the comments are here.
Sorry. My name is Mr. Rapp. Jackson Township resident, Equinox, Pennsylvania, property owner also. I want to voice my opposition to the one permit, one process, is that what it's called? To the adoption of that. I consider it to be just a streamlining of the natural gas agenda. It's. I'd also like to impart on the commission that currently we have a system that worked to our advantage, us environmentalists, that fracking miraculously was kept out of the Delaware River Basin, and smartly so. And any streamlining of the process that currently worked well, I would say, is taking a risk too far. So I'd like to hold up the sign for you, because I think it's illustrative of today. And it says, stop fracking democracy. We have a democracy that was supposed to respect the rights of citizens to remain on their land unmolested. And yet we see processes like this where if the Republican-backed gas people don't like the outcome of the game, they try to circumvent and change the rules. So please don't change the rules. Please don't approve the one permit, whatever you're calling it, one permit, one process, change to your rulemaking. And continue to stand in defense against natural gas drilling in the Delaware River Basin. If anyone here has been watching Boomtowners playing on channel 163 on my dial, which is Smithsonian channel, you're getting a good firsthand look at the changes that fracking brings to a community and a state. It starts out explaining that the light emission just from the burning of the additional natural gas is creating enough light to equal that of New York City. I think that fracking, in my opinion, is...
Can you
give
comments on one process, one permit? We'll have a public dialogue in a little bit.
Sure. Okay. I think I said sufficient on that process. Please don't weaken it by allowing the Delaware River Basin Commission's authorities and or decision-making processes to be changed in any way. They seem to be working well to date. I see no reason, if it's budgetary or any other reason, I would take a good look at who's asking you to change them and take a good look at what their agenda is. And you may understand why and how we came to be trying to adopt this change. Thank you.
Thank you for your time. Anyone else like to speak on this matter? Not seeing any. One more.
Hi. I'm really short. My name is Patty Kronheim, and I'm a coordinator for Hopewell Township Citizens Against the Pennies Pipeline, and thank you for having this public hearing. I have to say, it feels really good to be here at the DRBC. I've been at a lot of different kinds of public hearings in the last 10 months, and this is by far the most public-friendly place there is. And that alone is enough reason for me to not want there to be one process, one permit. State politics are, by its very nature, political. It's just the nature of the beast.
New governors come in, and the DEPs in those states are all influenced by the governors to varying degrees depending on the governor. Well, that's what's so great about all of, about the DRBC, is that you have checks and balances. And those checks and balances are crucial, just crucial, to the impartial and environmentally conscious regulation of our of the Delaware River Basin. And anything that impugns that, or to use a water analogy, dilutes that, is a hazard to all of the people in all the states affected by the Delaware River Basin. Currently, New Jersey DEP is definitely been showing a pretty poor track record when it comes to water. They're being sued currently by a group for improper permitting and rushing of the Transco lighting line, gas line. New Jersey now accepts fracking waste. So there's a real history here of a degradation of water quality in the state of New Jersey. And while I understand wanting to have a easier and more efficient policy, and I applaud the attempt to do that, there are a couple of things I do disagree with it in the basis premise that the whole purpose of a regional organization is that it isn't going to be run by any one state. So I think one of the most important things, and I'll agree with the Riverkeeper's comment on this, is number one is that the DRBC needs to be the lead agency. If you're going to enter into compacts with the states, you have to be a lead agency. And that would also include that you would continue to have the current public input that you have, because it doesn't exist elsewhere. And I can say firsthand, having to go to these kinds of meetings, it doesn't exist in any way, shape, or form in the same way that yours does from the very beginning of the process. And the second piece is also to have the DRBC give real teeth to the evaluation of this. If you decide to go through, which I hope you don't, but if you do decide to go through, to give real teeth to the evaluation of this program when the demonstration period is over, and to allow the public to also be part of that evaluation process, but to make sure that you have the language written that it can be objectively evaluated. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Public comment period will be open until July 1st, 2015. We'll be accepting comments through then. We're going to be ending at 5, so if you're eating into the public dialogue, if you'd like to do one more comment.
Yeah.
I'll try not to eat too much. Very briefly, my name's Mary Ellen Noble. I'm with the Delaware Riverkeeper Network. And aside from everything else, my main concern is that if this goes forward, it's going to be very difficult to track any particular project, know where it's at, where to get the information, when it's going to be open for comment, where to comment. And I don't understand how that can possibly be done, especially with the information we've been given so far. You say you're going to put a list up. Are you going to, every time a new application comes in, I'm hoping that comes up. I want to know where to go. I don't want to turn up at the last minute and say, I haven't a chance to see this thing, but it doesn't look good. And that's all I get a chance to say. And I really have to learn a whole new place to go somewhere in Trenton in a process that I don't know before I get it in order to speak to you on the subject. So I see real problems for people. And I think people have come to really rely on this commission for an outstanding public input process. And we all sort of hate to see any of it go away, if indeed it will. So that's my basic concern.
Thank you. Yes, Mr. Kovach, once again, the public comment period will be open until July 1st. Again, we have a very full agenda today. I'm trying my hardest to get through both the public hearing and the public dialogue and still end on time. So we're going to start with the dockets now. We're still in the public hearing. Let's just go back and review the dockets.
Commissioners, I have 37 projects for your consideration today. 37 projects I'll present to the public for their comments. Of those 37 projects, three of those are located in Delaware, two are in New Jersey, five are in New York, and 27 are in Pennsylvania. I'll go over the projects in three batches as normal, the first batch being those projects with notes that are renewals with no substantive changes, and I'll go through those en masse. The second group of projects will be the renewals with substantive changes, and the third batch, which I will do individually, and the third batch will be new projects, which I'll also do individually, and I stress that the new projects are not always new to the world, but they are new to the commission. The first group of projects are the renewals with no substantive changes. They're up there on the projection. The wastewater treatment plants approvals are in blue, and the water withdrawals are denoted in black. There's 23 projects, or numbers 1 through 23 up there, and the omission is 19, which is a project that was held for further consideration. Those projects did have some comments that were received after the dockets were made public, so there was a number of minor revisions made to them. The village of Monticello, for example, had a clarifier that they're abandoning and no longer using as an equalization tank, as well a filter belt press in that project will be utilized instead of a sewage lagoon and reed beds. In the case of project number 6, Pennsylvania American Water, that project is located in the middle SPW, not the upper SPW, as was indicated in the docket. Project number 7, Northampton Borough, the downstream water supplier was Allentown. Project number 15, Philomena, the minor modification is that the project is located in the lower SPW and not the middle SPW. Allied, project number 18, the downstream user is also Allentown. Those were the minor modifications. Other than that, there was no substantive comment on any of these projects. And I would ask that you ask if there are any comments from the commissioners and any comments from the public on any of these projects presented here.
Commissioners, have any comments? My only comment is I continue to keep this open. Number 6. Any public comment on any of these projects? I don't believe I have any of the comments.
The next group of projects are those renewals with substantive changes. The first of those projects is project number 24. That's docket number D19690592. It's the Chemours Company. In Pennsville Township, Salem County, New Jersey. It's for a surface water withdrawal. It's for the renewal of a surface water withdrawal of up to 1,314 million gallons per month from an intake on the Delaware River. The water is used for non-contact cooling and industrial processes at the Chambers Works facility. The docket holder's freshwater sources were previously approved by DRBC docket D19930192 and are currently regulated by the NJDEP in accordance with the DRBC NJDEP 2009 administrative agreement. Chambers Works became part of Chemours Company, which is owned by DuPont currently. That company will spin off on or about July 1st, at which point in time they'll be a separate company. Next slide. And upon that, at that time, the certificate of entitlement that the project has will terminate upon that assumption. Condition C2I requires a docket holder to prepare, submit, and prepare, prepare and submit a drought management and contingency plan to the DRBC for the executive director's approval. Project number 25 is the Newcastle County Department of Social Services, Delaware City, Newcastle County, Delaware. It's a wastewater treatment plant. It's approval of an upgrade of the existing 0.57 MGD Delaware City Wastewater Treatment Plant, also referred to as the Governor Bacon Health Center Wastewater Treatment Plant and its related discharge. The upgrade consists of replacing existing sand filters with cloth media filters and replacing the existing chlorine contact disinfection system with UV disinfection. The wastewater treatment plant will continue to discharge to water quality zone 5 at River Mile 60.6. Project number 26, D1983-009-3, is Occidental Chemical Corporation. This is Delaware City, Newcastle County, Delaware. It's an industrial wastewater treatment plant. It's an approval of a modification to the docket holder's existing pump and treat groundwater remediation system. Modifications consist of replacing the existing damaged outfall pipe for the IWTP with a new outfall. The IWTP treatment system will not be modified and will remain permitted to treat a flow of up to 0.3 million gallons per day. Manufacturing operations at the plant ceased in 2005, and the plant is essentially being used to treat remedial groundwater and stormwater runoff from the site. And this IWTP will continue to discharge the Delaware River in water quality zone 5 at River Mile 62.7. Project number 27, D1985-028-CP3, is the town of Rockland. It's the Livingston Manor facility in Sullivan County, New York. It's located in Upper Delaware Special Protection Waters, wastewater treatment plant, and it's a renewal of the 0.8 MGD wastewater treatment plant and its discharge. Approval of proposed modifications to the docket holder's wastewater treatment plant that are substantial alterations or additions. They're converting the treatment plant to an SBR facility that, and it will not result in an increase to the hydraulic capacity of the wastewater treatment plant. Modifications to the emergency power source and remote alarms are required to ensure the modified facility meets our SBW requirements. And grandfathered loads were established in that docket. They submitted a report on April 13th, 2015, that due to the proximity to the floodplain and the land being unavailable nearby, that additional space for natural treatment alternatives was not feasible, and we agree with that conclusion. They have provided flood protection for their facilities, and the nearest surface water intake of record for public water supply is located on the Delaware River, approximately 175 river miles downstream of the docket holder's wastewater treatment plant, and that's operated by the City of Easton. Project number 28, D1994-050-CP3, this is Delaware Valley University, was formerly known as Delaware Valley College. It's in Doylestown Township, Bucks County, Pennsylvania. It's a groundwater withdrawal in the Southeast Pennsylvania Groundwater Protected Area. And it's the renewal of a groundwater withdrawal with an increase in total system allocation from 6.34 million gallons per month to 7.192 million gallons per month from 6 project wells. It's used to supply public water to their system. The project wells are located in the Sepaguapa, as I mentioned, and the project wells are completed in the Stockton Formation, and that's in the Neshaminy Creek watershed. Project number 30, D2003-023-3, is East Penn Manufacturing Company in Richmond Township in Berks County, Pennsylvania. It's a groundwater withdrawal. Then this project is the renewal of that groundwater withdrawal with an increase in total system allocation from 20.67 million gallons per month to 31 million gallons per month from 9 project wells. It also includes the approval of their new production well number 11. The withdrawal is used to supply their battery manufacturing facility for industrial processes, cooling, and potable use. The project wells are completed in the Lytheville Dolomite Formation, except for well number 8, which is in the the granitic gneiss in the Muslim Creek watershed. One modification to that docket that to the one that went out for public hearing was it didn't include the groundwater monitoring plan. That was an omission that we caught a little later on. So that condition has been reinstated in this docket. That continues the groundwater monitoring program that they've been doing for the last over 10 years. Next slide. So that concludes the renewals with substantive changes. I'd ask at this time if the commissioners have any comments or questions, and thereafter if you could ask the public for their comments.
Any comments from the commissioners on 24th and 30th? Hearing none, we'll open up to the public. There are some people who had signed up in advance. On number 24, Bill Wolf and George.
Good afternoon, Bill Wolf from Bordentown, New Jersey. Just prior to this public hearing, I was on a national conference call with the investor community, first time ever on that wavelength, for briefing investors who control over $100 billion in assets about some of the financial risks and remediation and liability implications of the DuPont-Chemours spinoff. Your briefing left out a very critical fact, is that the SEC has not issued its effective notice of their Form 10, so the effective date of that legal transfer is July 1 at best, and there are regulatory issues with SEC, there are regulatory issues with the Department of Justice, there are regulatory issues with EPA,
and it is... I'm just going to interrupt you for 1 second. Can you start the clock? I apologize. You can have the 3 minutes from here, so I apologize.
It's only $1 billion enterprise, don't worry about it. So at any rate, there are regulatory implications, and these are not a mere administrative transfers of permits, all right? And this is being portrayed as an administrative transfer of a permit due to a corporate spinoff, and that's not quite accurate. And the spinoff itself loads the Chemours Corporation with all DuPont's liability for environmental remediation and litigation. And it gives them an asset that's underperforming in the titanium industry. It's a formula for bankruptcy, all right? And I think you don't have the staff resources. I was brought into a world of financial analysts and corporate people I had no clue on. But the point is, there are legitimate people making very legitimate arguments, and you do not want the DRBC to be the first entity in to administratively transfer a corporate permit like this. All right, as far as I know, EPA hasn't done it. I've been working on several facilities on DuPont on the Jersey side, and I'd urge you very strongly to table this thing until at least EPA has spoken and the SEC has issued its formal final approval. You have no business jumping in, it's particularly taking the lead on this. You should be the last in. With respect to the merits, I read the proposal. You left out the fact that they're currently using, on average, over the last 4 years, 600 million gallons a month. Why do they need $1.314 billion? You can't allocate water on a speculative basis. Apparently the applicant is seeking that water for speculative future economic development at the site, which is unspecified. So there's no justified need for that amount of water, and it's probably perceived within the corporation as an asset. So again, The applicant has not prepared a drought management or water conservation plan in accordance with your regulations. Again, that allocation may come down considerably if you look at real demonstrated need and water conservation. So it's, again, premature to issue 1.314 purely as a transfer because you don't have the need demonstrated for that. I think it'll be obvious once they do go through some kind of need or justification process, they'll not be able to demonstrate a realistic, feasible additional 700 million gallons a month. And therefore, if you factor in water conservation of 15%, that number is going to come down big. And I didn't see you do any of that kind of analysis in the staff reviews. So at any rate, please do not give DuPont our water. Thank you.
Nobody else signed up on
I'm George Fluke, and I think I'm going to be on the New Egypt plumbing.
Yeah, I apologize.
Okay.
Got ahead of myself. If you can bear with me a little bit, we'll get it. Any other comments on the...
I see a hand.
Mary Ellen Noble, again, with Delaware Riverkeeper Network. I remember reading in the newspaper about Chemours, and it was posited or thought that, yes, they were putting all their bad apples into one basket. And I thought, ha! And I must say, it seems to me that the gentleman is making a very good point. I can't speak to the details. I'm wondering whether you guys can. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Hi, I'm Ken Collins from Andover, New Jersey, and I would like this comment not to just be on this docket item, but on all docket items that concern additional water withdrawals. Your approval of any additional water withdrawals at this time is irresponsible and a failure to provide comprehensive watershed management by the DRBC. Your mission statement says you will provide comprehensive watershed management and act as stewards of the basin's water resources, particularly with respect to ground and surface water quantity, including water demands, water withdrawals, water allocation, water conservation and protected areas, and drought management. If, as the DRBC's core values state, you believe in serving the public, treating everyone with fairness and respect, and acting in an open, honest, and professional manner, and listening and responding to your constituents, I'd like you to listen to the words of Dennis Hart, former Assistant Commissioner of the NJDEP and former NJ State Drought Manager, who recently wrote, "Now is the time for us to examine our water supply. This examination must include the following: water conservation measures, including the reuse of treated wastewater effluent, need to be implemented in a vigorous manner. I submit that the DRBC needs to evaluate all effluent and require all who release effluent to find as many ways as possible to reuse that effluent. As we teeter on the brink of a drought..." Would you hand me that newspaper there, sir? "As it says on the front page of the May 29th Star Ledger..." Thank you. "It is bad stewardship and poor watershed management to approve any additional water withdrawals at this time. Your failure to provide comprehensive watershed management and act as stewards of the basin's water resources, specifically in regard to conservation and drought management, will result in people washing their dogs on top of their cars parked on their lawns this summer just so they can get away with it. I urge you to deny all additional water withdrawal requests before you at this time and implement effluent reuse requirements immediately. Thank you."
As this gentleman comes up, I'm just going to say that please keep your comments to the dockets. We do have a long list of public dialogue with signed in advance, and we are in jeopardy of not making it through that list. So I just want to comments are welcome.
My name is Scott Northey. I represent DuPont Chambers Works and Chemours Chambers Works facility. Just like to address some of Mr. Wolf's comments. I'm not sure all that his comments are founded on factual information. The company is proceeding forward with a July 1st spinoff of the Chemours company, and Chemours will take ownership of the Chambers Works facility. DuPont and Chemours are committed to obliging their environmental responsibilities and their regulatory requirements. For the basis of our withdrawal, we're actually asking for a reduction in our entitlement by about 60%. So we'll actually be asking for less of a withdrawal in that area. It is below the salt line. It is non-consumptive use. Basically, 99.9% of that water returns to the Delaware River Basin. So I respect your comments, but I'd just like to say that Chemours and DuPont are committed to following regulations and respecting the water sources of the Delaware Estuary.
Any other comments?
I will say regarding the Comoros project, the transfer of ownership that may occur on July is dependent on that transfer of ownership occurring at that point in time. So the docket won't transfer until that change occurs.
Correct.
Yeah, once it's approved, once the ownership changes, however that is approved, that's when the docket transfers.
Subject to SEC approval.
The docket will transfer once it. Certain. The next batch of projects are those new projects. Again, not necessarily new to the world, but new to the commission. The first of those is the Tennessee Gas Pipeline Company 300 line project. This is an after the fact approval of the construction of a natural gas pipeline. Surface water withdrawals and temporary discharges of hydrostatic test water and a special permit for the pipeline within a floodway and flood fringe areas in accordance with the Commission's floodplain regulations. The project was placed in service on November 1st, 2011. Loop 21, 321 of the project extends from Susquehanna County and the SRB, that's the Susquehanna River Basin, into Wayne County, Pennsylvania. Approximately 16.4 miles of the loop is located in the Delaware River Basin. Loop 323, 14.9 miles in length, is located entirely within the DRB inside of Pike County, Pennsylvania. Next slide. Approximately 1.5 miles of Loop 323 is located in the Delaware State Forest, a recreation project area in the Commission's comprehensive plan. Withdrawals for hydrostatic testing occurred were made from Dyberry Creek, that was 2.98 million gallons, and Chihola Creek, 2.56 million gallons, and 0.2 million gallons of water from two local public water supply systems were used to gather water for hydrostatic testing purposes. After testing, the water was discharged in dewatering structures and with energy dissipation devices at five separate upland locations in Wayne and Pike counties, Pennsylvania. Project number 32D2014-014CP1 is Tinicum Township. This is their wastewater treatment plant located in Delaware County, Pennsylvania. It's the approval of the docket holder's existing 2.8 million gallon a day wastewater treatment plant and its discharge. The state's and DRBC's effluent limits have been based on a flow of 1.4 million gallons a day. Wastewater treatment plant will continue to discharge treated effluent to tidal portions of Darby Creek, the river miles indicated on the slide, within water quality zone 4. There are no surface water intakes of record for public water supply within a 5-mile tidal influence of the docket holder's discharge. The modification from that went out to public notice, the findings and decision sections of the docket have been modified with respect to toxicity to match language from effluent table A1, which requires annual monitoring instead of quarterly monitoring. Project number 33, that's D2014-018-CP1, is the Girl Scouts of Freedom Valley Wastewater Treatment Plant in Haycock and East Rock Hill Townships, Bucks County, Pennsylvania, located in Lower Delaware Special Protection Waters. It's approval of the 0.045 MGD facility and its discharge. State and DRBC have based effluent limits on a flow of 0.015 MGD. Wastewater treatment plant will continue to discharge treated effluent to a 0.2 mile long drainage swale of Tohican Creek that consists of constructed wetlands above Lake Nockamixon at River Mile, those river miles indicated on the slide. Decision condition 2N requires an emergency management plan be prepared and submitted for review and approval within 6 months of docket approval. And the nearest surface water intake of record for public water supply is located on the Delaware River, and that's operated by North Penn Water Authority. Project number 34D2014-020-1. This is Villa Roma Country Club in the town of Delaware, Sullivan County, New York, located in Upper Delaware Special Protection Waters. It's the approval of an existing groundwater and surface water withdrawal of up to 12.276 million gallons per month to supply domestic irrigation and snowmaking water from wells 2, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 12, and 13, as well as two intakes on ponds. That's intakes number 11 and 15. The nine project wells are completed in the Honesdale Formation, and the two pond intakes are located in the Jonesbrook watershed. All 11 withdrawal sources are located within the drainage area to upper Delaware SPW. Project number 35D-2014-021 CP1 is the Richard Becker Walnut Port Mobile Home Park in Lehigh Township, Northampton County, Pennsylvania, in Lower Delaware SPW. It's a wastewater treatment plant with a capacity of 0.05 MGD. The wastewater treatment plant continued to discharge treated effluent to Birch Creek at the river miles indicated on the slide within the drainage area to Lower Delaware SPW. Condition 2N requires a docket holder to install a permanent generator capable of providing emergency power and a remote alarm system. The nearest surface water intake of record for public water supply is located on the Lehigh River, approximately six river miles downstream of the docket holder's wastewater treatment plant, and that's operated by Northampton Borough Authority. Project number 36D-2014-023-1 is PPL Utilities Corporation Northeast Pocono Reliability Project. It's an electric transmission line located in multiple townships in Monroe, Lackawanna, and Wayne County. This is in Upper and Lower Delaware Special Protection Waters. The Delaware River Basin portion of the project consists of 44.5 miles of 230 kilovolt transmission line and 10 miles of 138/69 kilovolt transmission line and one substation. The project alters approximately 77 acres of wetlands in the DRB. During construction, 3.7 acres of wetlands will be temporarily impacted through the use of timber matting. 14 of the 403 monopoles located in the DRB are located in wetlands and will permanently impact 0.065 acres of wetland. Portions of the project pass through Lackawanna State Forest, which is designated in the DRBC's comprehensive plan as a recreation project area. The right-of-way width of the 230 kilovolt line is approximately 150 feet. The right-of-way width of the 138 kilovolt line is 100 to 200 feet wide, depending on the location. Project involves 55 aerial stream crossings. Three monopoles are located within the floodplains of Meadowbrook and Butternut Creek, and the docket constitutes a special use permit in accordance with the Commission's floodplain regulations. The project is located in the Lehigh and Lackawaxen watersheds in Lower and Upper Delaware SPW. Project number 37D-2015-001 CP1 is Aqua America's Wetherill Dam, their withdrawal on Perkiomen Creek. It's the approval of that existing surface water withdrawal with a total system allocation of 16.5 million gallons a day or 511.5 million gallons per month from that one surface water intake at the Wetherill Dam. Surface water withdrawal is used for public water supply in their system. They have a certificate of entitlement, number 133, that allows them to withdraw 94.848 million gallons per month for consumptive use and 634 million gallons per month of non-consumptive use without charge. Project number 38D-2015-002 CP1 is for Plumstead Township Municipal Authority. That's located in New Egypt Township, Ocean County, New Jersey. It's for a new wastewater treatment plant. The docket approves the incorporation of the new 0.6 MGD New Egypt Wastewater Treatment Plant project and its associated discharge into the comprehensive plan. The wastewater treatment plant will consist of a membrane bioreactor treatment system along with equalization, screening, ultraviolet disinfection, and re-aeration. The wastewater treatment plant will discharge treated effluent to non-tidal portion of Crosswicks Creek at River Mile 128.5-21.3, that's the Delaware River and Crosswicks Creek. The docket requires final plans and specifications for the wastewater treatment plant to be submitted for executive director approval prior to initiation of the construction. The docket requires $4,000 of the project review fee to be submitted by June 18, 2015, and the remainder of the project review fee by December 31, 2015. The nearest surface water intake of record for public water supply is located on the Delaware River, approximately 27 river miles downstream of the docket holder's wastewater treatment plant, and is operated by the Lower Bucks County Joint Municipal Authority. Project number 39D-2015-003-1. This is another Chemours project. It's for the Newcastle County, Delaware surface water withdrawal at the Edgemore facility. This is approval of an existing surface water withdrawal of up to 345 million gallons per month from an intake on the Delaware River, river mile 72.8. Water is used for cooling purposes and industrial process at the Edgemore facility. Edgemore became part of Chemours, a wholly owned subsidiary of DuPont, on or about July 1st. That ownership will, that Chemours will be spun off, and they would take ownership of that docket at that time. And the docket holder's certificate of entitlement will terminate upon Chemours' assumption of ownership of the facility. I think that's it for those projects. We did receive a number of comments on those projects with regards to the Tennessee 300 line. We did receive comments from the Riverkeeper. We are still reviewing those. They did come in this morning. But largely, they were summarizing violations that took place while the 300 line was under construction, effects on land disturbance and wetlands. We're still looking at those comments. With regards to the PPL project, we received comments from a number of commenters, eight in total, those being Philip Mosley, Don Gorham, Mike Helbing, Paige Francis, Ronald Ashton, David DeVoe, Robert Cici, Barbara Smith from the president of North Pocono Care. Those comments largely had to do with wetland impacts, alteration of wetlands from one type of wetland to another, requests for increased mitigation on the PPL line project. There was also a lot of concerns regarding stream and wetland buffers and riparian zones. With regards to Plumstead project, that being project number 38, we received three commenters, that being Bill Wolf, Catherine Ross, and Kelly Ripkema, probably butchering her last name. The Catherine Ross and Kelly Ripkema, they mainly had concerns with the Abbott marshlands downstream of the discharge, the 20-odd miles downstream of the discharge. The limits that we put into the Plumstead docket are end of pipe effluent limits. We don't look at changes down at the river in this area of the Delaware River Basin. Bill Wolf's comments were slightly more lengthy, and I imagine he'll comment on them today. Just to address one of those comments, there was that the DRBC shouldn't be moving ahead of NJDEP's permit on this project, and I just say that the DRBC has a fairly long track record of both going before and after the states have issued permits. So at this point in time, I would ask that you ask the commissioners if there are any questions or comments on these dockets, and thereafter the public.
Any questions or comments on the list 31? If you have a list of people from the public, I would ask that you please keep your 3 minutes, use it all if you'd like, and give some back if you can. And please stick to the docket comments. Tamara Clemens and Kenneth Collins on the Tennessee Gas Pipeline, number 39.
Did you say Tamara Clemens was before you?
Is Tamara here? Okay. Kenneth Collins.
Kenneth Collins from Andover, New Jersey. By approving this, you betray the public's trust. I just want to make sure you understand that and it's clear. At your last meeting, I asked you this, and I will ask you once again, what actions has the DRBC taken to ensure the public that you will not fail to do your job as you did in this case? Anyone? Okay. It is absolutely, completely, 100% unacceptable that the DRBC, you, failed to identify your responsibility, resulting in the project being built without proper oversight, your oversight. Never should anyone be coming before the DRBC and requesting permission after the fact for something they have already done. It is absurd, should never have happened, and your failure to identify your oversight highlights a failure in the DRBC's policies that must be remedied right away. Just because it was your fault doesn't mean you should grant this permission unless you are just covering your asses. If the public is to trust the DRBC to provide comprehensive watershed management and act as stewards of the basin's water resources, you must identify what resulted in your failure in this matter and what actions you are taking to avoid failing the public and your mission statement going forward, and make that known to all of us so you can restore the public's trust in the DRBC. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Maya Austin.
Aaron Stempelwitz from my staff is going to do our presentation.
Thank you. Aaron Stempelwitz from the Delaware Riverkeeper Network. DRN has identified a number of glaring issues that were either entirely omitted or not adequately addressed in the draft docket, and we implore that the DRBC either table this for further review or reject it outright. We have provided comments as indicated earlier that are much more detailed than what I'm going to state here today, but I just want to highlight a few things. First, the Commission's scope of review is so narrow that it constitutes being deficient. In an April 10th, 2013 letter that the Commission sent to the Tennessee Gas Pipeline Company, they stated that the Commission's review will focus on the as-built project, including site restoration, erosion and sedimentation control plans, post-construction stormwater management, and plans for disturbed stream area restoration. However, the proposed docket narrows the scope of review. Specifically, it's stated in the draft docket that the purpose of this is to examine the withdrawal and discharge of surface waters and to look at the TGP's compliance with the Commission's floodplain regulations. By circumscribing the stated purpose of the review to the withdrawal and discharge of hydrostatic testing waters, the Commission cannot have made an informed decision with regard to whether the project substantially impaired or conflicted with the Commission's comprehensive plan, which is the standard here. Such a narrow scope of review is both legally and factually deficient. Relatedly, the Commission also failed to evaluate TGP's numerous notice of violations, noncompliance actions, and discharges during the construction of the project. TGP accumulated at least 20 separate notices of violation from the Pike County Conservation District alone, at least 15 notices of violation from the Wayne County Conservation District, and over 71 different violations from Federal Energy Regulatory Commission environmental inspectors. As a result of these different violations, the Pennsylvania Department of Environmental Protection actually settled with TGP in excess of $800,000 for these violations. Where there's smoke, there's fire. There was clearly violations here. However, in the draft docket, you'll notice that nowhere are any of these violations even mentioned, let alone examined. How could the DRBC have made a decision on whether or not the standard that the compact requires was indeed violated without a more in-depth review? Lastly, I'd like to say the Commission also failed to evaluate TGP's three other interdependent and segmented pipeline projects. In June of last year, the Delaware Riverkeeper was successful in a suit against the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, where a federal court of appeals found that the TGP 300 line upgrade project was actually one of four separate projects. And in fact, it was just one whole project. The Commission must examine all four of these projects together in order to get a better idea of what happened and simply not rely on a review of one of these segmented four projects. Our further comments have been submitted electronically, and I'll submit a paper copy here as well. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Just a quick point of clarification. I think you said twice that the commission approved it. The commission hasn't approved it, but staff has recommended it. So those might not be the exact words you use, but you apply that action is already taken. So action is not taken.
Thank you. And we encourage that the commission either table or set aside or reject this draft docket. Thank you.
Okay, I'm going on to 36, unless there's anything else in 31.
Just very brief. I think this whole process is backwards. You don't allow violations first and permit later. I think this should be held. Thank you.
Thank you. Going on to 36, Kenneth Collins and Ronald Action. Either Mr. Collins, Mr. Ashton here. David DeVoe. And Don Warham. I'm going to move off to number 36, which is TPL Utilities. Sir.
May I speak to 36 very briefly?
Yes.
Thank you.
Again, Aaron Stemplitz from the Delaware Riverkeeper Network. With regard to this project, we would like to ensure that to the extent that the DRBC exercise their jurisdiction over this project, that the DRBC include explicitly that this project, was the review of this project was triggered by RPP 2.35A12. This provision of the rules and practice and procedure dictate that the Delaware River Basin Commission will exercise jurisdiction over projects that involve over 25 acres of wetland impacts. As indicated on your slide, there were over 77 acres of impacts here. So to the extent that the triggering mechanism was not explicitly defined as being 235A12, we would like the draft docket to be tabled until such time that is reflected properly. And secondly, we would request that it appears as though an expert report commissioned by the Delaware Riverkeeper Network was used and submitted to the Delaware River Basin Commission regarding wetland impacts. As such, we would like the opportunity to comment as well on that project. We have not commented today. So again, we request that the DRBC table this until the next meeting. Thank you.
Bill Wolf, Wharton, New Jersey. Just before I start, in response to staff's characterization of my comments and staff's response, completely inadequate, didn't summarize point by point the issues I raised, and had no substantive response to either of them. And the position with respect to the commission's prior approvals prior to a state NPDES program or after, if there's not a uniform policy, I think there are very significant criteria and factors here to say you should not go first. And let me now get into those points. There are technical issues with respect to that should be before the commission's jurisdiction, dealing with a new sewage treatment plant on a low-flowing headwater tributary to the river. And it's also a substantial deviation from state policy with respect to discouraging those facilities for more than a decade. That alone should raise some red flags to say we need to take a closer look at this, what's going on. Secondarily, I've raised specific technical concerns with respect to the anti-degradation review, with respect to the metal effluent limits, and with respect to some of the technical assumptions about stream flow with the US EPA, and they have not responded yet in writing. I've asked for their review of this permit. So again, it would be premature. You should wait on the EPA expressing their review, or you should wait on the state's final permit. And again, none of those things have happened yet. I was told that the DRBC staff were involved for a long period of time in the planning of this project, that there were preferable alternatives that were rejected without good technical rationale. None of that history was in the record that I was reviewing as part of the state's permit. It was not discussed in any public setting. I was told it off the record by staff. Those kind of concerns should be made transparent. They were not in your staff recommendations. They deal with things like feasible alternatives to a new wastewater treatment plant that are economically and environmentally superior. The other point that, again, should be a major concern is that the 1Q and 7Q10 low flows in the stream have, over the period 1990 to 2010, according to the applicant's own data, are 45% lower. So the low flows are diminishing inexplicably. Again, you've got issues in that basin. It's a small basin. You should be able to figure them out. And again, it's a DRBC concern. It could be happening on a larger scale. You don't want this kind of precedent to be that kind of sloppy review by the agency. And lastly, the state has issued water allocation permits for 274,000 gallons a day, and the sewage treatment plant is permitted at 600,000 gallons a day, which is an explicit violation of the state's own GPDs and water quality management planning rules, which require consistency between the water allocation, water supply side, and the wastewater discharge side. These are major issues. These are not, you know, your standard run-of-the-mill things. The anti-degradation review was used in such a way that the applicant used an anti-degradation review to say the effluent limits for metals were not applicable because the costs were too high. That's something that should never be sanctioned by the DRBC.
Thank you. I'm Mary Leck. I'm Emeritus Professor of Biology at Rider University, and I'm a member of Friends for the Abbott Marshlands. And I've worked in the tidal marshes of Crosswicks Creek for 30 years. I wish to speak against the permit for the sewage treatment plant as presently described. I am concerned that the amount of effluent that leads to the amount of effluent will lead to increased stream erosion, that added sediment will impact on tidal wetlands downstream, as well as cause degradation of nearby habitats, and that there will be reduced water quality. The estimated impact of added effluent at 1 to 1.6% is based on data from the Extonville gauge located 8 miles and 7 tributaries downstream. The impact should be reevaluated and based on actual flow at the point of entry. Paddlers can find water levels too low for canoes during August through November, October. With regards to erosion, the addition of 12,500 to 2,500 gallons per hour of treated effluent will increase water volume and movement in a very constrained stream bed upstream of the bridge. The soil in the area is sandy and susceptible to erosion. There was obvious erosion on both upstream and downstream areas of the Crosswicks Creek, and I've provided some photos, and there were pictures that were taken in December. There is no indication that attention will be given to erosion and sediment control following construction, nor to determining how increased water flow will impact levels of sedimentation downstream and in tidal areas. Increased water flow and or flooding would impact the nature of the floodplain vegetation both upstream and downstream of the bridge. Carl Anderson, co-author of Plant Communities of New Jersey, a Rutgers University Press publication, considers the entire Crosswicks Creek floodplain in that area to be the best of that kind of habitat in South Jersey. There is no indication that plans indicate a riparian buffer management plan. I am also not convinced that treatment will be state of the art. Arguments are made in other documents for socioeconomic trade-offs that appear to allow for less stringent quality regulations. The socioeconomic trade-off will enhance development in a designated agriculture development area and an area that is part of the Pinelands Management Plan. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. I just looked up my watch. Still afternoon. George Fluke. My wife was Leona Fluke.
We represent a number of organizations, one of which certainly is the Sierra Club. We're also known as the Piney Paddlers. My wife and I run over 100 events per year in paddling and kayaking and training and water cleanups, and work with the drbc projects as well. So we're very familiar with the waterways of New Jersey, including the Crossways Creek. And the only thing that I want to bring up is something that sometimes when you're a paddler, you see things that you may not see in the scientific side or in the technical metrics. One of the things that we see, I should also say that I'm a farm owner for over 45 years in Mercer County, so I'm well aware of farming practice and irrigation and water use and runoffs and what have you. But paddling the Crosswicks is an interesting experience from Oakford Lake, from the headwaters, all the way through. We've done it for years. It's generally very low, it's generally very walkable. As mentioned, there's one gauge, and that gauge doesn't tell the whole story. When you reach various places where there's farming, and farming's been done for a long time, typically in the curvature of the creek, it's an ideal place for a farmer, like myself, or farmers of 30 years ago, to actually do hand dredging and machine dredging and create a reservoir right in the creek. And then they have their big pumps and the diesel pumps, and they pump and they irrigate. And of course, they're done dynamically. There's no schedule, it all depends, okay? So they're gonna pump their reservoir right in the middle of the creek. It might be below the gauge, above the gauge. If it's above the gauge, all of a sudden the gauge might read real low. One day you have 4 inches of water, the next day you have nothing. What caused it? Okay, for paddlers, that's one of the things we ask. But if, say, one of those reservoirs is there and they irrigate, now what happens, the flow has to refill that reservoir, okay? And there's at least four or five along the creek. You paddle it, you can see the big diesel pumps. That is not accounted for. But the way we do it, if we see the level change, you can't look at the gauge. You gotta be there. You gotta paddle it. You gotta walk it. And that creek is really in bad shape. To put any effluent in there is not, just not a good thing. And the technology of sewer plants today, you can take the water from your wells, you can treat it, you can recharge your aquifers right there. You're not moving your water out of region. So they're just the points I wanted to bring up. Thank you.
Good afternoon, I'm Peter Elvisacker, the Executive Director of the Plumstead Municipal Utilities Authority. What I'd like to do is not take up the time going over every point. The DEP, as you know, held a hearing on their draft permit back in December of 2014. And since that time, we responded to 13 different comments that were made on the our application for a surface water discharge permit. So as I mentioned, rather than taking the time to go through each and every one of them, I did submit a copy of the responses as part of the record, and I'm happy to leave a copy with you today. If I can just quickly summarize, we've been at this for a very long time. We simply do not have a viable alternative. We've looked at groundwater discharge. We've looked at an interbasin transfer, which to the Ocean County Middle Treatment Plant in Brick. The total distance would have been something like 27 miles. We have, through the county and our own initiatives, made efforts to regionalize with the joint base. There were two major studies done. We met with the Assistant Secretary of the Air Force. Their decision was, we can't accommodate you. So this is the only alternative that we have. And everything that we've done indicates that it will be a safe and certainly state-of-the-art discharge to the Crosswicks Creek. We can't clean up our downtown, our Oakford Lake and the Crosswicks Creek, which are affected by malfunctioning cesspools, now outlawed, undersized septic systems. We cannot revitalize our downtown. We're a Main Street community. We have been a state designated growth center since 1998. So the area that we're talking about serving is very small. The township has also preserved over 3,000 acres of land in farmland and open space. The impact on the Abbott's Marsh that was mentioned, 26 miles down the stream, there are three dischargers in that vicinity already. The control will be a controlled release, so the erosion that was talked about simply will not occur. But again, in summary, I think we've addressed all of the comments that we heard at the DEP public hearing and what I've heard so far today. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Yes. 38 Homestead?
Good afternoon. My name is Peggy Gallos. I'm the executive director of the Association of Environmental Authorities in New Jersey. For more than 40 years, AEA has represented water, wastewater, and solid waste utilities that are owned and operated by the public. Our members provide services from the Atlantic to the Delaware and from Cape May up to the northern reaches of New Jersey. More than 5,000 men and women work in our member organizations. I just wanted to mention that water quality improvements that have been achieved so far in New Jersey are to a great degree creditable to wastewater treatment plants, and that this wastewater treatment plant is a responsible environmental solution and a financially feasible solution. And therefore, given that it meets all of the regulatory requirements, we would urge you to move it forward. Thank you.
Jeff Tittle, director of New Jersey's Sierra Club, and we did comment on the DEP NPDES permit. I just wanted to be very brief and say this is the exact kind of application on why you need to do your own independent review and should not have one-stop shopping for permits. And the reason is that we've had members that have been involved with this issue for a very long time. There were alternatives. The mayor rejected them because they want to actually bring a new development because he thinks it's going to help their tax base. It's not about cleaning up the downtown. It's about the fallacy of a ratables chase that's being done at the expense of clean water. And I'm just going to go through the list. Based on DEP's own documents, it does not meet the standards for total dissolved solids. It does not meet for TSS. It does not meet it for metals, especially copper. It's a depletive use of a river that's already in decline. And on top of it, you're going to be putting out more phosphorus into a river that's already impaired for phosphorus. So where's the cleanup? Again, I think that the DRBC has to have that independent review and has to look at this in the scope of the basin. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Move on to 39.
I'll just refer to my same remark as the administrative transfer.
Any other comments on the last slide? Okay, I am going to, unless there's any other matters in the public hearing, with that, I'm going to close the public hearing. Besides the process of the permit, is there any comments you want to give it? Let's move on to the public dialogue. Similar ground rules as we discussed for the public hearing. Staff and commissioners are not going to respond to any questions. At times, staff or commissioners may offer clarification if needed. We need to end at 5 o'clock. We might take 14 people who signed up in advance, and we've got another seven or so who I have cards for. My guess is we have a few more, so we might just make it. I recognize that several people have signed up to talk about the Penny's project, specifically the issue of whether or not there will be a joint hearing with the FERC. In fact, commissioners are well aware of efforts by some, including the DRBC network, petitioned the DRBC not to have a joint hearing, and have seven hearings on the Penny's dock. I will say that as of yesterday, the commissioners are fully aware that we received online petitions and received a press release from the Delaware Riverkeeper Network indicating that there were some 3,600 signatures on an online petition regarding this matter. Personally, I've seen a related one from MoveOn.org with over 1,100 signatures. Most, I will say, of the signatures are from this area, in my review. There were also signatures from outside of as far away as El Paso, Texas, quite a few in El Paso. I don't know what's going on there. Quite a few in El Paso, California, Seattle, Portland, Colorado. So it's an online petition, and certainly there were many people who signed on, and I'm sure we'll hear about that in a bit. The petition also comments and references that the DRBC will be limiting comments to 2 minutes. I'm not sure where that came from. I will say everyone recognized today the need to have a time limit, hopefully, and the need to manage public hearings. The DRBC never indicated that there was a two-minute limit. On the petition, I'm just reading from the petition information. It says, set your petition timer for 2 minutes and say out loud what you're concerned about penalties. The DRBC is proposing a combined DRBC FERC hearing that will allow the leader 2 minutes to make a comment. That's not accurate. There's no decision made at this point about the procedures related to these hearings. So the fact that the petition stated that we were proposing a two-minute limit is not accurate. So it goes on to say we need a lot of people to hear us. 2 minutes just isn't enough. Again, we're fully aware of the press release that went out yesterday. Again, I'm sure we'll hear more about it. I was forwarded the press release and the letter that I sent to the Riverkeeper about this matter. Obviously, I wasn't quoting everything I said, but let me read to you some of the things that bracketed the quote, because I think it reflects the DRBC's position on this. So right before the quote that was in the press release, let me read what was there. It says the DRBC has not received a formal application for the project, and that's accurate. We expect to receive one, but we do not have an application for the Penny's project. It yet alone developed a draft document. Once the application process is further along, fair and adequate procedures for the public meetings and public hearing can and will be established. So we haven't established anything yet. We certainly are in dialogue with FERC, but nothing's finalized. At the end of the quote, what was left off at the end, DRBC is what I'm going to read now. The DRBC commissioners and staff appreciate their concerns and will keep them in mind as we work through the procedural options available to us, and that is a bit down the road. In addition to the online petitions, the DRBC received over 125 letters. Most of them were form letters with language provided by the Delaware Riverkeeper Network. Some were not, most were. We also received another online petition with 108 signatures through MoveOn.org. That one's about eminent domain. So the commissioners are fully aware of the online petitions, the numbers of the online petitions, the press release that came out yesterday. Those who'd like to speak on Penny's are certainly welcome to do so. Please know that the commissioners have the information, and as long as time is available, certainly you can speak to that. Like I said, the session will end at 5 p.m. So I will reiterate again that in terms of how we're going to deal with the next section, I think we'll start with a 3-minute limit. I'm not sure where the 2 minutes came from, but we'll start with a 3-minute limit, and we'll get make sure that the 14 people signed up in advance have the full 3 minutes. If you can be generous and give some time back, please do, although you certainly can use the 3 minutes if you'd like to. The seven people who sign up after that, I'll consider seeing how that goes, depending on how much time we have left, and then we'll go from there. So I'm going to read the list as I got it. So it's not subject by subject, it's person by person. If I can find the list, we'll start. First person on the list is Jeff Taylor.
to beat Maya.
That never happened before. How did I beat Maya? Sorry. Thank you. I just wanted to reiterate that this commission has a very important responsibility in protecting the basin and to make sure that when there are plans for infrastructure, that they get the right scrutiny and that independent review. We're concerned by having a joint meeting with FERC that that will not happen because FERC, unfortunately, has been much more rubber stamped for the industry they're supposed to regulate than they have been an independent agency. And our concern is that because of the scope of this project and the potential impacts crossing 88 streams and literally thousands of small tributaries cutting through wetlands and parks and open space and going pretty close to the main stem of the river, that's going to have significant impacts, fracturing forests and so on. And so that's why we really believe that you need to have your own review independent of FERC without them involved because of their undue influence. Two, that review has to be comprehensive and look at secondary and cumulative impacts and follow along on the lawsuit that Maya, the Sierra Club, and the Highlands Coalition won against FERC and TGP. And on top of that, what we are concerned about, given the size of the basin and the scope of the project, that there are enough meetings in the different parts of the basin that are impacted, and that's why we've called for 7 hearings, because you've got places like Hopewell on one end and Lackawanna County on the other end and all those places in between. And I can tell you from being involved in this issue that every time there's been a meeting, whether it's a FERC hearing where 500 people showed up and even more came and they closed off testimony, or up in Clinton Township with more than 300, or on a snowy night up in Bethlehem, more than 300 people showed up. There's a tremendous amount of interest in this issue, and the public needs a right to have appropriate input, as does the technical experts, the environmental groups, and the other groups that are involved in this issue, and the property owners have, because you're going to need to hear from all those experts and all the people who want to really be involved. The last point I just want to leave you with, it's been 5 years since the moratorium on fracking has been in place, and we thank you for it, we hope it becomes permanent, but we are being fracked by pipelines, cutting ugly scars through this basin, where they build the pipeline first and come in for permits later, as we've seen happen time and time again, where we've seen road collapses and violation after violation. And that's why we're here. Don't let them frack this valley through pipelines. 200 years ago, we fought a battle for freedom in this valley. It was a battle against the Hessians and the British. The British are the gas company, the Hessians are the pipelines. They're trying to destroy this valley again, and we need the Delaware River Basin Commission to stand up for the people of this basin and to stand up for the environment and to do their job and to allow the proper public hearings and inputs. Thank you.
Thank you, Langdon.
Good afternoon. Thank you for the opportunity to address you today. My name is Jeff Waldron. I'm a resident of Holland Township with a home approximately 1.5 miles from the Delaware River. Running along my property is the Harry Hohackey Creek, which is a class one trout breeding stream which feeds directly into the Delaware. Traversing my property is a feeder stream to that Harry Hohackey, and located as well on the property is a recharge for this stream. I'm here in regards to the PennEast project. I do not believe that such a meeting is in the general public's or the 50 million people who depend on this river's best interest. I can ask you to consider a series of open meetings with input from affected peoples and townships and without FERC. Your own webpage talks about Oliver Wendell Holmes' quote that a river is more than an amenity, it is a treasure. Currently, it's a treasure that is being plundered. Your values are not reflected by FERC or by PennEast. As I stated, I am an affected landowner in this discussion. The current pipeline is proposed to cut my property in half, sitting approximately 100 feet from my home, crossing the feeder stream that I just mentioned, and running parallel and downhill from the recharge, which I also mentioned. My experiences with FERC and with PennEast have not been productive or positive. I'd like to expand on that just real quick. It began when the PennEast land agent came into our home last August. He threatened my wife and I, telling us that our property would be surveyed without our permission, and that if we were unwilling to be cooperative, that it would be taken from us using eminent domain. We attended three of the four open houses hosted by PennEast in hopes of more information and cooperation. Our questions were not answered by the representatives. Instead, we were sent around the room telling us that we had to ask somebody else. We complained to the FERC representative who was present. She stated that it was too early in the process and that we would have a chance to express our concerns at the scoping meetings. We attended the scoping meeting in Hampton, New Jersey, and we were among the 30 people who were denied the opportunity to speak. We submitted extensive written comments to FERC, only to have our concerns clumped with other concerns and then boilerplated robo-answers from PennEast. In April, we attended a PennEast open house for landowners only. When we mentioned inaccuracies in their maps and their information, they told us that they would consider making corrections only if we granted them permission to survey our property. We have felt abused and extorted in this process to date. My wife and I are busy medical professionals. We've spent considerable time and energy and, you know, taking time off and away from our patients, only to be denied a voice in this matter. We implore the DRBC to get involved. You know, we have the rights for life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. When were they subjugated to the whims of private corporations? FERC is unwilling to kind of look at the cumulative impact of this entire project. It is your mission to do so as the steward of the watershed. You know, if everybody wanted, sorry, thank you.
My name is Winifred Waldron. I'm a landowner in Holland Township. I'm married to Jeff. And I'm directly impacted by the PennEast project. I was hoping to speak to FERC and at a scoping meeting. I signed up and I was denied the ability to speak. I sent in my letters and questions to FERC. PennEast response, and specifically I asked them if they're going to be using herbicides. The response was they will not be using pesticides. At the landowner meeting, I asked them the same thing. They told me they would not be using pesticides. So I'm a physician. I know what pesticides and herbicides and the effects of them on people are. I know that they can affect other living things as well. So there's a distinction, and I'm not getting the answers that I have asked. The answers to the questions that I've asked. Anyways, I have a lot of other questions and concerns as well, and I'm really concerned about the cumulative effects of the pipeline on the water. I'm concerned about the construction. I'm concerned about the maintenance. We have arsenic on our property. We're at the 5 parts per billion cutoff, and which is considered dangerous by New Jersey if it's above that. And I'm afraid of what's going to happen, and I haven't gotten any answers from that either. So I would ask you to please give us a chance to express our concerns and make it a separate hearing from the FERC hearing. So I know that I'm not the only one with multiple concerns. I mean, arsenic is one of them, the herbicides is one of them, the location of the stream that is on our property, and the angle that the pipeline is going to be crossing it and then running parallel to it is concerning. I know there are living things in that little stream. I've seen the salamanders. I've watched my kids catch the turtles and play with the turtles. I know that there are things there that are concerning and living, and nobody will speak for them. So again, please reconsider letting us have a separate meeting. Thank you.
Thank you very much. My name is Tom Shepstone. I'm the publisher of a natural gas advocacy blog, but I'm here today as a seventh generation Upper Delaware landowner and also a planner from that area who knows how critical natural gas development is to our economic future. It's been nearly 4 years since this agency, under different leadership, I might add, arbitrarily delayed a vote on already prepared comprehensive gas drilling regulations for 1 month, then 2 months, then 3 months, and then forever. without regard to the needs of our area for water to conduct hydraulic fracturing and save our economy. That is part of the DRBC mission. And it was that day surrendered to a mob mentality by those whose case has long since been proven baseless, as recently affirmed by the EPA. It has been an incredibly frustrating experience for landowners who attempted to make their case in the proper way. We were encouraged by the gas companies and others to work within the system. We made our comments respectfully. We even made a trip down here to meet with your staff at that time, and we were lectured about the threat to forest in our area, even though we've been steadily adding forest cover for over a half a century. We patiently listened. We, in short, attempted to persuade. And in the end, sadly learned, it was intimidation that worked. Indeed, only 5 months prior to the Delaware Riverkeeper suing your agency over the regulations, your deputy director was writing to her saying, "I'm concerned there will be an effort to water down or eliminate well pad component of our three-legged stool regulation framework. Please work on the New Jersey constituency to be sure that this comes to some sort of vote. We have three ayes and only two nays. Please keep this note to yourself." That's what was going on. Then after the Riverkeeper sued, your agency proceeded to delay the regulations by entering into a contract for further studies with the funder of the Delaware Riverkeeper, the William Penn Foundation. These unconscionable delays at our expense must end, and I urge you to pick up where you left off and vote on these regulations. And I also respectfully ask that you hold some of these meetings a little north of this area. It would be nice if you had a meeting in Trenton. I'm sure we can find a facility with security there for you, or in Easton, I mean, or Stroudsburg or someplace like that. But we drove 3 hours down here today, spent probably another hour in backed up traffic to get here to make it 3 minutes of comment, which we're very appreciative of. But I'd appreciate it if you moved up to the north, where you could hear a few more of our constituents speak to you about our concerns. Thank you very much.
My name is Ingi Krafik-Kiklak. I'm a landowner in New York State. I want to take this opportunity to bring us back to basics. The DRBC was formed in 1961 to manage the water resource in the Delaware River Basin. In the DRBC mission statement, the commission promises to act as steward and to protect the surface and groundwater quality through regulation, demand, withdrawal, conservation, and the protection of sensitive areas. The commission is to do this by incorporating interests of many parties, including economic and environmental needs, through the use of sound science. Your core values include listening and responding to your constituents. Thank you for this opportunity. You do this to improve your expertise, another core value. My suggestion is to look to your sister River Basin Commission, the SRBC, to learn from their experience with the most concentrated gas development in the country, perhaps the world. Since 2006, the CRSBC has been monitoring ground and surface water in their catchment area, continually upgrading their field monitor on both headwaters and downriver areas. By 2013, they had 58 sites uploading data to satellite on an hourly basis, 365 days a year. This data is simultaneously available to the public. From the data, the SRBC has concluded that there have not been any negative impact or no degradation trends in ground and surface water. They are spike interpreted suspended solids, meaning muddy water. In some instances, where pipelines cross river and streams and in heavy development areas, but these conditions are temporary. This data is basis of your sound science. It's not theory. It is continual long-term data collected by a reliable and transparent source. These were lessons learned by the SRBC in the process. Learn from them. Learning is one of your core values. Finally, your mission in managing the water after the Delaware River Basin calls for finding a balance between economic and environmental needs. You have the tools. Please don't waste them. Thank you.
Bill Wolf and Betty Sutton.
Hi, Bill Wolf, Bordentown. I had really didn't really sign up to take this spot. Haven't done a lot of work on pipelines. Respect everybody's concern with respect to local impact. But I brought the issue of pipeline review to the before the Pilings Commission with the South Jersey Gas proposal. And I think it's generic to all pipelines is that, it's, you know, of course there's a disturbance associated with it, but it's the product flowing through the pipeline, the fossil fuel, and the climate impacts that are obviously the most significant. And they get no regulatory attention or planning attention. Fossil fuel infrastructure and the need for it, or the fossil fuel infrastructure's secondary and cumulative impacts on the climate, both in terms of emissions along the pipeline route from the upstream, up in the life cycle assessment of the fracking operation through the combustion of the fossil fuel. And I was under the impression that, geez, a while ago, the DRBC started looking at the issue of climate change adaptation. So on the one hand, you're recognizing that extreme weather events are changing your hydrology of the basin, and you're trying to examine how you're going to manage that prospectively into a very bleak-looking future, and that the statistical baselines that you've projected no longer are in play given extreme weather. And yet, at the same time, you're not even looking at that issue with respect to projects like fossil infrastructure. So with respect to, I guess you'd call it the scope of review or the methodology under which you conduct your analyses, I would just beg you to somehow factor in climate change, as, and I would find it as a compelling basis to reject any approval. I mean, if you have a moratorium on fracking, it just seems obvious that you would have a similar moratorium on the conveyance of the product produced at the fracking site. So, and if you need a basis to do that, the incremental effect of the greenhouse gas loadings are obviously going to affect your hydrology in the basin. And that's known science now. So you need to connect the dots somehow in a planning and regulatory way to begin doing that.
My name is Betty Sutliff, and I am a genuine Damascus citizen since birth. I serve on the executive committee of the Northern Wayne Property Owners Alliance, and I also happen to know the executive director of the Groundwater Protection Council, Mike Pack, personally, and I spoke with him at length last week. 3.5 years have elapsed since the vote on natural gas regulations was supposed to take place. You have had ample time, 6 years, to sift fear from fact and science from the chicanery. Now, especially in light of the report just out by the EPA, stating in essence that fracking is not a weapon of mass destruction, but is safe, you are without excuse in delaying the vote on natural gas regulations any longer. Any further delays would only speak to the ineffectiveness and inefficiency of the commission. In my opinion, the delay is not and never has been about safety and water quality. Tom Shepstone, who spoke earlier, has researched and written extensively on the dark money side of this. The people of Wayne County, who overwhelmingly support natural gas, are tired of being used as political pawns and having their economic future determined by the widely discredited and irrelevant Josh Fox. We have been harmed enough. You, the leaders, need to step up to the plate and do your job. Get your hands out of the land use issues and wellhead construction where they never belonged in the first place, according to your compact, and pass the regulations. We do not need, as I said, special interest groups, which to us would be the well-funded anti-fossil fuel activists, determining what we can and cannot do with our minerals in Wayne County, Pennsylvania. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Maya Vamrasam. I'm the Delaware Riverkeeper. I'm here speaking today on behalf of 16 organizations and over 3,800 individuals. The organizations are the Delaware Riverkeeper Network, Burke's Gas Truth, Pipeline Safety Coalition, the Clean Air Council, Bucks Concerned Citizens Against the Pipeline, Holland Concerned Citizens Against the Pipeline, West Amwell Citizens Against the Pipeline, Environment New Jersey, Penn Environment, Sierra Club New Jersey.
You can't block
these. These are your signatures.
Okay. We'll accept those. You really can't block the exits.
I'll roll it up and bring it to you.
Thank you. I'm sorry.
May I have my 3 minutes back, please?
Sure. Go ahead.
Good afternoon. I'm Maya Vamrasam. I'm the Delaware Riverkeeper, and I'm here speaking on behalf of 16 organizations as well as 3,800 individuals who would like to present to you today a petition with their signatures. The organizations are the Delaware Riverkeeper Network, Burke's Gas Truth, Pipeline Safety Coalition, the Clean Air Council, Bucks Concerned Citizens Against the Pipeline, Holland Concerned Citizens Against the Pipeline, West Amwell Citizens Against the Pipeline, Environment New Jersey, Penn Environment, Sierra Club New Jersey, Sierra Club PA, Clean Water Action New Jersey, Food and Water Watch, the Sauerland Conservancy, the Gas Drilling Awareness Coalition, and the Palisades Environmental Action Committee educators, who along with 3,800 individuals are presenting to you a petition in order to reiterate our request that the Delaware River Basin Commission hold hearings separate from the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission on the PennEast Pipeline Project. And we are asking that you hold 7 such hearings across the length of the proposed pipeline route. We don't doubt that when the DRBC requested joint hearings with FERC that you thought you were being helpful to the public, but we are here to let you know that the opposite is true. When we speak about the individuals testifying, only having 2 or 3 minutes to testify in such a joint hearing, it's based upon the past practice of both the Delaware River Basin Commission and of FERC. Both of you limit public testimony to 2 to 3 minutes. So it is not a stretch to imagine that you would continue that same limitation in a joint hearing. Joint hearings would deprive the public of a fair and reasonable opportunity to be heard, and it also deprives you of the good information that the public has to provide. The petition that we have presented to you reads, "We, the undersigned, are calling for separate DRBC and FERC hearings on the PennEast Pipeline, and are calling on you to hold hearings in 7 towns along the pipeline route. We are taking you at your word that when it comes to considering the PennEast Pipeline proposal, you are, quote, committed to a public process that affords interested persons an opportunity to comment on issues of concern to them, and to, end quote, efficient use of public resources. The best way to accommodate the most people with the least travel is for your DRBC team of just a few to travel to our communities of thousands and to give us the time to be heard. The best way to ensure that we have a full and fair opportunity to be heard is to let us speak directly to DRBC about DRBC regulations, mission, and mandates, and for us not to have to be burdened with speaking to FERC during the same time limit. We're urging 7 hearings across the length of the pipeline because it means a hearing every 10 to 20 miles of pipeline. It means greater accessibility of these hearings. It means less travel time for those who will be affected. It means less cars on the road burning dirty fossil fuels. And 7 hearings means less chance of time running out and people turning away without having an opportunity to speak, as happened at the FERC hearings. Thank you for considering our request."
Can she change my place? Because Inga just spoke. I'm signed up later. Sandra Davis.
What's your name?
Sandra Davis. I signed up after. And
Inga took Vic.
It'll be Patricia, and Inga already went, and Sandra is next on.
Thank you.
Thanks. My name is Patricia Sieber, and I'm speaking as Executive Director of Friends of Hopewell Valley Open Space, a nonprofit land trust that has been preserving and caring for land since 1987, including Bald Pate Mountain, which would be crossed by the proposed preferred alternate route of the Penn East Pipeline. This proposed route would cross a number of small tributaries on Bald Pate that flow either to Fiddler's Creek or Moore's Creek, both of which are classified as trout protection waters under the NJDEP surface water quality standards. Both of these creeks flow into the Delaware River, which is migratory and breeding habitat as far north as Lambertville for Atlantic and short-nosed sturgeon. Both species are listed as endangered both federally and by the state of New Jersey. Disturbance of the creeks and their tributaries and the vegetation bordering them, which acts as pollution and sediment filter, would compromise water quality. These impacts would occur not only during construction of the pipeline, but very possibly into perpetuity due to removal of vegetation buffer and pipeline maintenance activities. I specifically addressed impacts on Bald Pate. However, the proposed pipeline route crosses dozens of other streams that discharge into the Delaware River. The cumulative impacts of this disturbance need to be weighed by the DRBC, which is charged with protection of the Delaware River watershed. Your mission is very different from that of the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, which raises the question as to what would be the benefit of having a joint public meeting of the two organizations. My experience attending recent former DRBC meetings and this one has shown to me that you are courteous and welcome input from the public. I am sorry to say that this has not been the case at FERC meetings. I also believe that while this location of the DRBC meeting is convenient for my organization, which is right across the river, it is much more difficult for affected individuals and organizations located upstream. They all should have a voice in their well-being and the well-being of their watershed, and I urge you to schedule multiple conveniently located meetings. I firmly believe that the public has much relevant information to offer, and in the interest of fairness, they should be heard. You have stated that you are committed to the public process that affords interested persons an opportunity to comment on issues of concern to them. That is laudable. Please abide by that commitment. Thank you.
Thank you. Sandra Davis, and
my name is Sandra Davis. I live on and own 55 acres in Delaware County, New York. I am a mother to three handsome boys, the wife of a dedicated construction worker, a farmer's daughter, fifth generation, and an environmentalist. Our family grew faster than most. We spent our life savings to adopt my two boys, only to become pregnant a month and 2 weeks after finalization. We live from paycheck to paycheck with no wiggle room in our budget. My family wants to continue living in upstate New York, but we are an endangered species. Like many young families, we may have to move and to provide opportunities for ourselves and our kids. The decisions of the DRBC will have a profound effect on my family's future. Like most commissions that guide the use of natural resources, you are charged to protect human health and welfare, to protect the environment, and to promote economic growth through sound management. While the DRBC focuses on the use of surface and groundwater in the Delaware Basin, you also must balance people, nature, and industry in a manner that fosters growth and opportunity for our region. It is not an easy job. Special interests come at you from all sides. I speak to you for my special interest, my family, and ask you to use common sense and reliable real-life experience and data to guide you. In our region, gas development offers the greatest promise for economic and human progress while sustaining and improving our natural resources. We ask that you turn to your neighbors, the SRBC, for their experience and guidance. They've formulated clear rules, they've enforced these rules quickly, and they've talked to industry to find common ground for solutions to common goals. The results, gas development has provided new life for a region that was headed on a downward slide. We need that kind of action in the Delaware Basin. The template for prosperity is right next door. Please use it. You can lift the barriers. You can give my husband the opportunity to work near home rather than travel 4 hours a day. And we, as a family, can enjoy all that the Delaware River Basin has to offer. Don't put my family in jeopardy of having to leave the Delaware area to find livelihood. It's all well and good to save the whales. How about saving my family too? Thank you.
Andrea Bonnet and Tina Green.
Andrea Bonnet from East Amwell Township in Hunterdon County. I'm speaking purely as an individual, although I am a former elected municipal official long ago. We, the residents of Hunterdon and Mercer counties, are dealing with first Penn East, which has repeatedly demonstrated they will do whatever it takes to get this pipeline built, and second with FERC and its consultant Tetra Tech, with conflicts of interest big enough to drive a truck through. This is about respect. FERC treats citizens as one might swat away annoying mosquitoes. They've changed meeting dates, the few that have even been allowed, deliberately to discourage public participation. They barred many interested participants from even coming in the front door. FERC has pretty much lost the confidence of the public. Penn East, I don't believe, even respects FERC. I have read hundreds of their documents and their vague and formulaic reports to FERC, which purport to respond to public comments, are laughable. I urge DRBC to take a different tack, one that demonstrates a very real concern for our environment. I implore you to schedule a series of meetings wholly separate from FERC so that our citizens have a meaningful opportunity for input. Thank you.
Hi, I came down here today from all the way up the river in Durham, where Penn East would like to try to ruin our community by crossing our pristine, exceptional value watersheds and our beautiful river. This is a true hardship to my family of four children and our farm that we rely on this water and all the resources. The people all along the path of this pipeline are screaming to be heard, and we're counting on the DRBC to help us because we've gone through the whole story with FERC. FERC and the DRBC are two totally different things, and we do not want any parts of a meeting together with the both of you because we've done the FERC scopings and we're not very confident with the way that their system runs, and we're really counting on you to hear the voices of the people affected that will be absolutely devastated economically and physically with our water supply if we can't convince and show the people that are here to protect us what's at stake. The cumulative impacts of this are tremendous, and I know you've heard all about this already. And the science that we've seen and I've learned over the past 9 months is staggering. I can't believe how horrible this is for permanent destruction of our area in the river basin. And where I come from, as also a farmer, and realizing how living paycheck to paycheck is hard, fossil fuel industry, there is no sustainable economic benefit with fossil fuels. We can only live with renewables. That's the only option. And this has come up over and over again, and it's a constant fight for people like us on the bottom of the food chain that are trying to constantly keep above water just to help our government agencies protect us, plus work, raise our families, do all these other things, and we're not getting paid to do any of this stuff. I spent 90% of my day trying to realize how we can live on our farm and grow food to feed our families because of the corporate interests coming in and bullying us. This is never gonna end. We have to move towards renewables, it's the only way. And we really need to have several meetings with the DRBC so that you can see all these people that are working so hard to try to spread this education to help people understand it. And we need you to be the bigger voice and just stop this project dead in its tracks so we can look at what we really need for true sustainable economic growth, which would be renewables to help preserve the precious water that we cannot live without. We cannot breathe and drink and eat gas or money. It's the end of the line with this. So I'm really asking that you could please come and meet with the people along the length of this path to be able to hear these voices of these families and residents that are crying out for help from the people that protect us. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Director. My name is Doug O'Malley, Director of Environment New Jersey. We represent 20,000 dues-paying citizen members across New Jersey, 30,000 additional residents, as well as, and I speak on behalf of our sister organization, Penn Environment Group, which represents more than 50,000 Pennsylvanians as well. And I just wanted to start off just by thanking you, Director Tambini, for sincerely not only reading the release and request from the 16 organizations and Riverkeeper, but also for considering it. Because I think it's critical that DRBC look at this request and consider what's going to happen when a hearing is held. And I just wanted to ask if any of the commissioners had had a chance to attend any of the FERC hearings in Pennsylvania or New Jersey that occurred this February? I'm going to assume not, but if you did, or certainly if you read the press hearings from it, it really was extraordinary. This was hours and hours of testimony from citizens that actually were much more broad and diverse than DRBC traditionally hears. You heard not only from the fossil fuel industry, which was actually a minority, you heard from folks representing real estate interests, you heard from developers, you heard from farmers, you heard from elected officials of every political stripe. And just to note, of those organizations that I just referenced, all of them had massive concerns with Penn East. And as we heard from a citizen that already testified, time ran out. People were waiting in the parking lots. State senators couldn't even get in because there were so many people there. So when DRBC is considering a public hearing process, obviously there needs to be an independent process. It cannot be tied by or with FERC. But when you're looking at what is going to happen, it needs to be more than one or two meetings. I just want to use an analogy from an entirely different world, and that's the world of transportation. One is the Port Authority, when they are in the process of jacking the tolls for the George Washington and the other bridges to New York, held three hearings essentially on the same day, all in the middle of the day, in very remote and hard to find public places. The other analogy in the transportation sector is much more recent, and that's New Jersey Transit. They're considering a fare hike. They held nine hearings in the course of 4 days all across New Jersey. And those hearings were well attended, and they only lasted 3 hours, but in some places needed even more time. Trust me, these hearings are gonna generate even more interest, and it's critical the DRBC not only look at the requests from the Riverkeeper and the assisting organizations, but also that the commissioners of these states look at that request and ensure that there are seven hearings so that we have adequate public input on this issue, not just one hearing. Thank you.
So it's 4:30, we've got a little bit of time left. I've got six comment cards, actually seven. I would say I have one from Ron Todd, who wants to speak on, I believe it's Transfer League Southeast. He said, the comment period for that is over. So the comment period is closed on that. After that, I've got six, and everyone's been very good in terms of keeping it to the time. So I think we'll get through these six, and then we'll open up after that. So I will work through Dave Pringle, and then Kerry, start with Dave.
Butch, probably.
What is it?
B-U-T-C-H?
B-U-T-C-H.
B-U-T-C-H, yes.
Like the name.
Thank you. My name is David Pringle. I'm the New Jersey Campaign Director for Clean Water Action. We have a million members nationwide, 150,000 in New Jersey, at least 350, which live in New Jersey, are part of that petition. In addition to the 16 groups, my organization, Sierra Club Environment New Jersey, Delaware Riverkeeper Network, all of our membership is in the watershed and is very significant. The fact that it's an online petition should not matter. Don't want to see the fact that it's online be diminished. It's as meaningful as anything else. Unlike this hearing, an online petition is a lot more convenient for people. Most folks can't take the day off, and perhaps you should find a location where you don't have to shut down at 5 o'clock. Those kinds of things are not give us great confidence that you will have live up to your words, that you believe in meaningful public participation. One hearing on a project like Penn East is not meaningful participation. So either be honest with us, you don't want really public involvement, or let there be public involvement. Multiple hearings in a 108-mile pipeline at different locations in different days at different times is the way to go, disassociated from FERC. Someone disparaged or misled you on what the EPA conclusions were. They did not say that fracking is fine and all things are wonderful. There are significant drinking water contamination issues. That was acknowledged in their report, and it was an extremely limited in scope report. So I'm sure you already know that, and when you read it yourself, you will recognize all of that. In reality, the public input is, like it or not, whether you admit it or not, this is a political process. You are being pressured by your bosses and by others to do X, and the public should have a role too. So you can allow the public to give you cover, to do the right thing, to do what you're supposed to do as commissioners and protect the watershed, protect water quality, and protect water quantity or not. So by excluding the public, you are making your job harder if you want your duty, if you want to do your job. So please do your job and have meaningful public input and protect the water supply and quantity, quality in the watershed. Thank you.
After that will be Jean
Rapp. Hi, back again, Carrie Margaret Butch from the League of Women Voters of New Jersey. I'm the executive director, and I thank you for the opportunity for coming here to speak, or for giving us the opportunity to speak. The League, as a good government organization invested in citizen participation, is requesting separate DRBC and Federal Energy Regulatory Commission hearings on the Penn East pipeline, and we are asking that you hold hearings in 7 towns along the pipeline route. The League of Women Voters of New Jersey asks that you ensure citizen participation and promote a fair and transparent and robust open public process. Limited FERC DRBC hearings will not accomplish this goal. The residents along the pipeline route have the right to a reasonable amount of time for their voices to be heard. Traveling to those communities and holding separate meetings is not too much to ask to ensure adequate debate and participation. The League of Women Voters of New Jersey has local leagues in many of the affected communities, and we know that citizens in these areas are eager for their full and fair opportunity to comment. These communities are calling out for action, and having a few members of the DRBC travel as opposed to thousands of citizens is the best way for the most people to be heard. In addition, because the DRBC and the FERC are different bodies with different missions, and because citizens are only granted a limited amount of time to speak, citizens should address the DRBC alone during these 7 public hearings. Like the League of Women Voters of New Jersey, we know that the DRBC is committed to increased public participation. We ask that you make that goal a top priority when scheduling these hearings, and thank you.
Hello, Jim Rapp. Yes, I'm gonna address this meeting today as bullet points, okay? Because I see a lot of emotion from the pro-gas row here of 7 people, and I just want to address some of the statements that they made here. I personally was with organizations who developed. Thank you. I love you too. I personally was with organizations. We delivered 120,000 petition signatures against fracking in Pennsylvania to the Pennsylvania State House a couple of years ago. I see 7 pro-gas people here today. As far as property rights, I stood in Inquinunk, Pennsylvania, in the middle of a land designated as a wild and scenic river by the national, by our federal government, and was approached by a gas man wearing a uniform from his service in Iraq. And he told me, we are going to develop this area for energy. Where were my property rights represented? Where were my property rights? Now, as far as people understanding or not understanding global climate change and the environment and their own self-rights, I want to make one thing perfectly clear. We are an overpopulated world. We have some wild and scenic areas that are pristine. If we do not preserve these areas as they are for future generations, they will be lost to self-interest, people who want to cash in on the fact that perhaps there was some gas under there. Now, as far as the EPA report, it has been mischaracterized several times in this meeting. The EPA report is not conclusive. It does not mention the tens of thousands of surface water contaminants released to drilling in the Dakotas. That is well documented. That water has not had its time to entrain into the aquifer. It has not had its time to make its way down waterways and pollute reservoirs and people's drinking water. But it will eventually. Nor has the time elapsed that scientists have said that these well casings are going to fail. When these well casings fail, the people who are living in these areas who do not have access to municipal water supplies will be directly negatively impacted. And I tell you what, unless these people in this row right here are willing to set aside a good portion of their monies and or sign an agreement that they're going to compensate these people for illnesses, asthma, cancer, sicknesses to their children, and my heart does go out to her husband, I have to drive 4 hours. But perhaps you ought to take a page from the people. If you need to go where the work is, well, maybe that's where you need to go. But we need to protect our natural environment so that we can sustain all life on our planet. Because we are losing species at a dramatic rate. We are changing our climate at a dramatic rate.
The humans are still here.
Thank you.
And it's fun.
Hi again. I'm Patty Kronheim. I'm a citizen from Hopewell Township, New Jersey. And I am one of thousands of people who live along the proposed path of the PennEast Pipeline. And I'm not going to talk about the merits or the risks of the PennEast Pipeline right now because this isn't the hearing for that, and I'm hoping to have lots of opportunity to do that with you all later. But what I am going to do is invite you all, invite you to our community, invite you to communities along the pipeline. I even have an invitation because nobody likes to be told what to do, but I do have an invitation for you all that I will leave, which says, come to our towns.
You don't have to say to me, bring it. I've been through hell lately. You don't address me, motherfucker. I don't know who the hell you think you are. Get off me. I am leaving. And that's where I was going when he addressed me. You have no business.
This meeting is not going to deteriorate with 20 minutes left. So please be respectful of everyone's opinion. We'll have a little bit of time left after the people who signed up, perhaps. We're not going to get into a shouting match back and forth and use that kind of language in this room. Thank you. Please.
Okay. It's just the invitation. And we all feel for everyone's pain all along this on all sides. I mean, no one wants anyone to suffer. But we do want to continue the conversation with the DRBC in a friendly way. We want to be good partners with the DRBC, and this is why it matters. And I'm going to share my experience, and I don't know if the clock went back to where it was before all that happened, but I think I lost a bunch of time. This is why it matters, and I'm going to share my experience with FERC, and it's the experience of many other people as well. I'm an optimist, and I'm a very stubborn optimist, which means I can be a very slow learner when it comes to something bad happening. I don't want to see it. So my first clue was Tetra Tech being hired by FERC, then the open houses that felt more like a police state with swarms of state troopers there, and where it was okay for union members to come up to people and say, you should support this pipeline, but it wasn't okay for rider students to have a petition, to have a, not a petition, to have a questionnaire, just asking people how they felt about gas infrastructure. They weren't even allowed to do it in the hallway outside. They were made to stand in the rain. Okay, this is the kind of things that have been going on. Limited scoping meetings, only one in New Jersey. We had a push for two in New Jersey. Then you get limited time. One of my favorite moments of disrespect was when FERC employees look at Senator Turner and say, could you wrap it up, Shirley? at the end of her testimony. This is the kind of thing that's been going on, and then we worked really hard to get the scoping comments in. I mean, we did work to exhaustion. That is not an exaggeration. And we got in tons of scoping comments. Over 7,000 topics were covered, and many of the best comments I've selected and given to you all so that you can have them, because it's not easy to work the FERC website. It's completely and wholly inadequate. So it'd be hard to find them. You hear all these scoping comments, the resource reports come back, most of them are missing. I personally submitted over 12 letters and over 400 comments I resubmitted that had been done in the pre-scoping period to make sure. When you look through the resource reports, my name comes up once under this general water issue concern. Okay? So this is why people don't have a lot of faith in FERC. And I'm going to continue on a little bit because I did get shorted. So these are what's happened, and the last point that really was the nail in the coffin of my natural optimism was me going down and visiting FERC. I went to see how they did business. I wanted to see for myself them approve a pipeline and see how they conduct themselves. I went down to FERC. There were numbers of members of the public, gas industry professionals, lobbyists. When I got there, what I witnessed was that the public were profiled. If they didn't think you were a gas industry worker or a lobbyist, they put a blue dot on your name tag and they shuffled you off into an overflow room. I was one of two people who got into the meeting because, as the gas industry later said in the press, I escaped the FERC dragnet. This is how they treat the public, okay? And when I left in protest, I stood up and said, I'm leaving because the public isn't here. I have to say I was escorted out by security and Homeland Security, because clearly I'm a very big national threat. So, and if you don't believe me, this is how FERC views stakeholders. They did a FERC PowerPoint that was given up in Maine, and this is from their website, from a FERC website. Problems on the horizon. And listed as problems are landowners and non-governmental organizations. So I implore the DRBC, please, to hold your own meeting. We're giving up hope. We don't want to give up hope. You have the power to give us that hope, so please, we're inviting you. We're happy to help you work to secure venues. It won't cost you anything. We'll find places to donate it, and we'll bring the donuts.
Once again, when I said there was 15 minutes left, I just continue to encourage respectful behavior, because we can't end at any time. I don't want to do that. I really want to get, I'm trying hard to get to everybody's comments. Might even have a little bit of time left. So, I have two left, and then we'll open them up. Fairfax, Hatter, or Hutter, and then Wendy Getz.
Hello, I'm Fairfax Hutter from Lawrence Township, New Jersey. I wasn't really planning to say very much, but I just wanted to say, please do not do a joint hearing with FERC. It just doesn't work. So, the FERC, the panel doesn't listen. They sort of rolled their eyes. And I was one of those who was denied access to that public meeting down in Washington, D.C. I hadn't even gotten in there. I had never done anything. And they just totally looked at people and decided if you had gray hair and your skirt was below your knees, you were probably a hippie, so you had nothing worthwhile to say. And that's exactly what happened. My other comment is that I have marveled at what the Delaware River Basin Commission has done as opposed to the Susquehanna River Basin Commission. My family owns land on a gorge that where a stream flows right into the Susquehanna. It goes right up to the river. So I watch regularly in Pennsylvania what is happening with the Susquehanna River Basin Commission, and just have wished so much that they would follow your example rather than the other way around. Anyway, just please don't do a joint hearing with FERC. Thank you very much. Bye.
Bear with me, gentlemen and ladies, because it does all refer and come back. And sir, I would like to speak to you most directly, being the federal representative here this afternoon. I will start similar to Zinn. Life right now is topsy-turvy. We're taking the and I'll take the conversation as my own as I continue. We stand on a line for the generations to come. For the generations, we play on a team that has never yet won. This struggle, this response, is not becoming of the totality or the potential of the human race. Now, the results of fracking are in. The data is here. Coral Bay in Northwest Hudson Bay, Canada, the amplification began to run amok. Temperatures and the averages in 2011 were recorded by the United States government at 54 degrees Fahrenheit above average. That's 5 years after it all began in 2006 and this spree of fracking and methane. The Arctic ice melt suffers a tragic plight, and kid us not, it is a direct result from the harvested methane here, permitted here in the United States, here at the DRBC, and here from FERC as well. Global warming comes first, accelerated warming of the Arctic next, and then, now, we are on a precipice of a global runaway effects, and the data is everywhere. The topsy-turvy supposition of mine is that we, the United States of fracking, are responsible for the current cliffhanger. You can find this information, as I relayed to FERC in PennEast Pipeline meetings, at arctic-news.blogspot.com. It describes in full the methane clouds and the jet streams that carry them. The global warming potential, the GWP, is initially 100 times more than carbon dioxide. And after 5 years, sir, I'm going to take just 5 seconds off my time to excuse you from your cell phone. At 20%, this cloud of methane is 1,000 times warming potency of the mass of the CO2 globally. That should concern you and your job here for the DRBC and protecting it. Oh, you're writing on it. I apologize. Thank you. I was trying to directly. So I started at Zinn, and we are currently warmer here in New Jersey and Pennsylvania, New York, and Delaware than it is in the Siberian Northern Arctic. It is gone. And the ice is probably, it's estimated it's going to be gone in 4 days. So what happens next? I ask for a ceasefire, if you will, a stop on all permitting of any new methane projects. I oppose all of the current and upcoming dockets, including the PennEast pipeline. Life on Earth has altering changes at our children's expense, and it must be addressed at length and be inclusive to all neighborhoods, all states, all organizations at 7 or more locations. And I think you should confiscate the baton and ban all the methane practices in the basin. Thank you very much.
Let's, if someone has not spoken yet and would like to speak, please raise your hand. Sorry.
Thank you.
We'll go with 3 minutes, but again, if you can leave some time behind, that would be helpful. That about, you know, just enough time for a few more.
I think I'll be a little shy in that.
Thank you.
My name is Kurt Cocadrilli, and I am from the Northern Wayne Property Owners Alliance. I'm a fifth generation Wayne County landowner. I grew up on a dairy farm in Wayne County in the Delaware River Basin near Lake Ariel, Pennsylvania. And I also have a hunting cabin a mere 300 yards from the Delaware River in Equinunk, PA. So I know the basin quite well. I know all the ups and downs and the ins and the outs and just about every creek for 100 square miles around there. It has been close to 4 years now that your draft gas drilling regulations have been put on hold to further the study, the science behind hydraulic fracturing. And simply put, it's time to pass the regulations and let us in the upper Delaware move on with our lives. In that time frame, since the stalled regulations, technology like hydrozonics and frac tech has also come light years from where it was when all of this process started in and around 2007. Most of all, drilling wastewater is being recycled and reused. Also, since that time, we have had Act 13 in Pennsylvania. The Delaware River Protection Act has been proposed, albeit not voted on,
There's been high quality, the EV upgrade blanket petition over the entire basin that has been submitted to DEP. Major overhauls of the PA oil and gas laws have occurred. DEP upgrades to regulations affecting water, and since 2011, zero discharges into rivers, lakes, and streams. I also will add that navigable waters of the USA was further defined. And in 2011, Governor Merkel called for EPA to study the science before he would support drilling in the basin. And just last week, on June 5th, the EPA frack study supporting the process came out. And the preliminary release calls the extraction process safe with isolated and manageable risks. Our other main issue with DRBC is the absolute conflict of interest the agency has when you have the Delaware Riverkeeper Network on 5 of 7 of your advisory committees. They are vehemently anti-gas, funded by anti-gas foundations, and have already sued and threatened to sue the DRBC again. Yet they are on your advisory committees. We think that is wrong. It's time to get landowners on your committees, as we are the major shareholders and stakeholders within the basin. Why are Wayne County residents being denied the opportunity every other Pennsylvania county has with viable shale gas reserves? You have catered to the rights of those folks downstream, and now it's time to cater to our rights and our ability to harvest our minerals. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. My name is Nicole Miller. I'm from Kingwood Township, New Jersey. I recently have taken an economics class at Rider on a graduate level, and I just was literally researching the whole thing after attending a school forum, an open forum in January. I definitely want you to have meetings that are definitely not related to FERC. For your company or DRBC to just specifically listen along the pipeline route, because to tell you the truth, I've been looking actively online for meetings that are scheduled. They're non-existent until after the fact. Two of them existed in the past 3 weeks in my town, and they're not even on the internet, and no one has access to any of the information apparently that FERC's been at these meetings. State troopers have been at the meetings, people in the town crying out that, you know, their property is being touched by the proposed route. And basically, no one that I talk to even knows until after the fact that the meetings are held. So what we would like is a scheduled, something that's out publicly, a schedule that people can follow. I would like to have attended for the past months many have meetings, and this is literally something that's been flagging me because it's consistently on the internet. So I would definitely like to see more meetings held. Second of all, I just want to say that basically I had to do an oral presentation, and I did choose the pipeline. I don't see anything positive coming out of this, including all the jobs they talk about. There's temporary jobs that will exist for 6 months approximately during construction, and there's about 2,500 of them, if that, and the only things that will exist in New Jersey are non-existent. No jobs in New Jersey, but Pennsylvania jobs will exist, approximately 10 of them for salary totaling $800,000. So we're talking about 10 jobs that are approximately $80,000 per year. So the husband back here or whatever must be following that, because there's nothing else consistent about it. Lastly, I would like to just, I don't want to take up too much time, but I do want to say that horizontal drilling is fairly new. Vertical drilling has been around for years. Directional drilling is the controversial issue here, And basically, they're learning more and more every day about it, including professors from different universities. I did want to just continue ending this on equipment failure. Valves and blowout preventers are failing at a high rate, according to the EPA. And that's where the problem is starting. Thank you very much. A lot to keep in mind. A lot of different issues. Thank you.
Not seeing anyone else, I would thank you for your input. I would suggest if you're interested in future meetings, it does help to sign up in advance. You have some idea of how to plan for these type of meetings. So I do thank you for your input. Thank you for your patience. Appreciate helping us get through a relatively long meeting. Thank you.
Dan, I did notice.